Thank you. That ends the budget statement from the Deputy First Minister. The next item of business is a debate on motion number 15181. In the name of Aileen MacLeod and the Land Reform Scotland Bill, I'll give a few moments. Ms Boyack, you have a point of order.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I wish to return to the point of order I made yesterday, which was then to register the fact that 23 hours before this debate we are about to have, we had not seen the Scottish Government's response to our Stage 1 committee report. So I was genuinely shocked after the Presiding Officer asked the Minister for Parliamentary Business to speak to relevant ministers. I was shocked when at 6:45 last night we received information from the committee clerks that the Scottish Government had changed its mind and that it was no longer going to be giving us their response in advance of our debate. I do think it's unsatisfactory. It's not just a matter of the committee members, but we have a break for recess and it's an issue of transparency and accountability for the stakeholders and members of the public who have a huge interest in this legislation. And I hope, Presiding Officer, you will be able to reflect on this and communicate with the Government. This is not helping the transparency and accountability stage of this bill. Thank you.
Thank you for our advance notice of that point of order. As a member will be aware, there is an agreed protocol between the Scottish Parliament and the Scottish Government in relation to the handling of committee business. This covers how the Government should respond to Stage 1 reports by parliamentary committees. While there is no requirement that a response will be made in advance of the Stage 1 debate, in this case, as the member says, I understand that the committee was given assurances by the Government that it would have a response on most issues in advance of the debate. The fact that the committee was only informed by an email to the clerks last night indicating it would not happen. The committee's report has been available to the Government since the 4th of December. The Government will also have been aware of the timetable for Stage 1 agreed to by the Parliament. The Minister may wish to reflect on the handling of this situation, which is both disappointing and not very helpful. I now call on Aileen MacLeod to speak to and move the motion. Minister, 30 minutes.
Presiding Officer, let me begin by expressing my gratitude to Rob Gibson and other members of the Rural Affairs, Climate Change and Environment Committee for the scrutiny over this session over a wide range of land reform issues. The committee's scrutiny of the bill has benefited significantly from the committee's already extensive knowledge of many of the issues at the heart of this bill, and it builds on the evidence provided by groups, individuals and, of course, the over 1,000 respondents to the Scottish Government's consultation on the future of land reform in Scotland, as well as those that contributed to the extensive work of the Land Reform and Agricultural Holdings Review Groups, not least the tireless work of the review group members themselves. It has been a massive task, which is reflected in the detailed Stage 1 report that the committee published just over a week ago. And on that, let me respond directly to the point that has been raised by Sarah Boyack in the Chamber just now, as well as in the Chamber yesterday, because at more than 140 pages, the committee's report provides substantial comment and recommendations, and we are now giving, you know, very serious and careful consideration to the committee's recommendations across all parts of the bill. And I very much look forward to debating these issues today, and I intend to submit our response to the committee shortly in line with the protocols agreed with this Parliament. It is a job that we want to get right rather than rush, because I'm really keen that we have the opportunity today to be able to listen to all the views across the Parliament and to be able to reflect that, you know, in members' views, you know, in our response. You know, this is a debate on the committee's Stage 1 reports, and we want to make sure that we have the right provisions in this bill that are not rushed. So it is important that we have the opportunity to listen to all the views in the Parliament.
Brief intervention. I'm grateful to do so, and I hear what she says, but would she accept that it does set us at a bit of a disadvantage when we have no clues the Government's response to the Stage 1 report? I'm disappointed she shows no sign of remorse whatsoever.
Minister?
Presiding Officer, this is a debate on the committee's Stage 1 report, and I'm very keen to make sure that we are giving an opportunity to members across the Chamber to be able to reflect their views so that we can use that in our response, in our response to the committee's report. This is a very complex bill. It's a very complex lot of provisions as well, and we're very careful that we want to take careful consideration of all the views that are represented.
I'm very grateful to the Minister for giving way. I think she will appreciate we're being asked to vote this evening on the general principles of the bill, a bill which the committee report has very exhaustively scrutinised and suggested a whole range of potential changes. It would be very interesting before we vote this evening to know whether the government accept all or any of these proposals in the committee report. We don't have that information.
Minister?
Well, that will be a matter for Stage 2, the consideration of the committees. But we will also be giving an indication in any case, and this is the committee's report at Stage 1. And I believe that we started this process with a good bill. I know that we can make this an excellent bill. And as the First Minister said last week at the Human Rights Innovation Forum, this government welcomes the growing interest in the role that human rights can play in achieving a fairer and wealthier society. You know, land reform, Presiding Officer, is a vital part of this government's aspirations for a fairer, more equal and socially just Scotland. And underpinning the bill is an ambition to fundamentally change the framework of legal and social rights and responsibilities to determine how our land is used and governed, to address inequalities and to ensure that our land delivers the greatest benefits to our economy and to all of our communities. And I am strongly encouraged by the committee's support for many of the general principles of this bill and of the measures within the bill. And certainly the creation of a land rights and responsibility statement under part one of the bill and the establishment of a dedicated Scottish Land Commission in part two underline this government's commitment to considered long-term reform and putting an end to the ad hoc stop-start nature of land reform that has limited progress in Scotland to date. Now, we must recognise the contribution of landowners and managers across the public, private, third and community sectors and the positive relationships that already exist between landowners, tenants and communities in Scotland. In doing so, we must also recognise the need to take steps to ensure that good practice is extended across the whole of Scotland. Now, part four of the bill has a vital role to play in encouraging and improving that engagement between our landowners and communities. And I'm pleased to see the committee's welcome of the principles behind this part of the bill in their report. And as well as ensuring cooperation and engagement, it is important to ensure a fair balance of rights between those that own the land and those that work, live and depend on the land. And at times, what can be achieved through voluntary and cooperative approaches may be limited. And although both the committee and the Scottish Government have agreed a voluntary approach to deer management that should be given the chance to deliver and substantial support has been provided to do so, it is becoming clear that more needs to be done in this area.
Can I ask the Minister reads the sections of our report which we discuss in great detail? The committee is deeply unhappy about where we've ended up with deer management, and across the parties there's a sense that we need urgent action and more provisions in the bill, and that the voluntary approach is absolutely not working everywhere.
Minister?
I set the point Sarah Boyack has made around the need to have an urgent review, and that is something that we will be giving careful consideration to in our response to the committee's report. I also welcome the committee's support for further powers for Scottish National Heritage, and part 8 of this bill will deliver the additional powers to intervene where it is shown that deer management is not delivering in the public interest. So I'll look forward to the committee and the Parliament's ongoing involvement as we focus on the 2016 review and taking the necessary actions to address the outcomes from that review. Now, part 10 of the bill is also about promoting positive relationships while ensuring a fair balance of rights between those that own the land and those that work, live and depend on the land. And it is encouraging, I think, to see some of the committee support many of the measures in part 10 and the principles behind those measures. And I also very much welcome the committee's support for the need to enable and empower communities across Scotland to have the confidence, the opportunity and the resources to own land for the benefit of the community. Now, the committee's support of the principles behind the provisions in part 5 of this bill to introduce a community right to buy land to further sustainable development is important in helping to achieve this aim. So I hope, Planning Officer, the committee and colleagues here today will also recognise today's confirmation from the Deputy First Minister that Scottish Land Fund will be extended to £10 million for 2016 and support the work of this government's short-life working group on the 1 million acre target. And the group's report was published just last week, and it sets out a detailed action plan to ensure that communities and landowners across Scotland have the support and the resources needed to understand and realise the benefits of community ownership. That report of the Short Life Working Group on Community Land Ownership is just one example that this bill is not the end point in Scotland's land reform journey. And I am very encouraged by the breadth of discussion on and support for the bill and the Scottish Government's wider land reform agenda. Throughout the consultation and the drafting processes, we have worked extremely hard to consider the wide range of often conflicting views and ideas around how we own, use and manage land in Scotland. And some of these conflicting views are evident even within the committee's report. There are no easy answers to these very complex and important issues. But it is important, Presiding Officer, that we continue to strive for better solutions, and there is always potentially room for improvement. I acknowledge that. I acknowledge that it is more work to do in that regard. And as part of the Stage 1 process, both the Rural Affairs, Climate Change and Environment Committee and the Delegated Powers and the Law Reform Committee's scrutiny of the bill has been highly valuable in highlighting potential areas where improvements can be made. And we will seek to respond fully to all concerns and the recommendations in our response to the Stage 1 report. And in fact, we have already confirmed our intention to replace the regulation-making power in Section 79 in Part 10 with substantive provisions at Stage 2, which will support 1991 Act tenant farmers to leave their holdings with dignity and security and increase opportunities for newer farmers. We have written to the committee outlining details of the intended proposal, and we'll continue to work with the committee and stakeholders as the provisions are developed ahead of Stage 2. We also intend to confirm our intention to bring forward amendments to strengthen the level of scrutiny for a number of the delegated powers contained in the bill. So further consideration, Planning Officer, is also ongoing on how best to provide Parliament with more information on the intended use of the delegated powers and to provide more detail and clarity about the provisions that are causing concern at Stage 2 as requested by the committee. Now, I appreciate this will be of specific importance for further detailing why the reintroduction of business rates for shootings and deer forests in Part 6 is not only fair, but will have a proportionate and reasonable impact on our rural economies, while also raising additional revenue that will help us to support community land ownership through the Scottish Land Fund. Now, as development and scrutiny of the provisions in the bill has highlighted, these are complex issues that require detailed consideration and thoughtful development. So while we are keen to bring forward additional measures where possible, we also have to be realistic about what is possible within the time available. There is a lot to be considered within the committee's specific recommendations on how to go further in Part 3 to ensure the transparency and accountability of land ownership in Scotland. But I am confident that the current provisions in Part 3, along with our wider commitments to complete the land register and develop a new land and property information system for Scotland, will go a long way to deliver that increased transparency. This is a complex area. Specific proposals to go further have to date struggled to provide effective solutions, and we are certain that some suggestions would be outwith the competence of this Parliament. However, there is more that needs to be done, Presiding Officer, and we are committed to continuing to consider what measures can be taken forward to achieve this aim. I'd like just about to finish, Presiding Officer. We cannot, Presiding Officer, in conclusion, roll back hundreds of years of history overnight, nor can we fix all the problems in one easy step. But we can, and we must focus on taking this next step in our journey. Presiding Officer, this bill will make a series of key changes to the way in which land is governed to ensure that responsible and diverse land ownership is encouraged and supported, that transparency of land ownership in Scotland is increased, that communities are helped to have a say in how land in their area is used, a thriving tenant farming sector in Scotland is supported, and that issues of fairness, equality and social justice that are connected to the ownership of, access to and use of land in Scotland are addressed. And I'm confident the majority of members here today will support the principles behind these most fundamental of our land reform objectives. and I look forward to continuing to work with committee members, with all members of this Parliament and with the people of Scotland as this bill progresses, to make sure that we get the detail right and that we achieve our radical ambitions for this bill.
Thank you so much. Now call on Rob Gibson to speak on behalf of the Rural Affairs, Climate Change and Environment Committee. Mr Gibson, up to 9 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This Land Reform Bill has generated a huge debate across Scotland about the very land we stand on. The RACI Committee's extensive programme of engagement ensured that the report we are debating today was informed by as many views and experiences as possible. The huge response to that engagement is testament to how much this bill means to so many people. We received 200 written submissions to the committee, held formal extensive meetings in Orkney, Skye and Dumfries, and travelled to the Isla, Jura, the Borders and Fife to hold public meetings to hear local people's views. Following this wide consultation, we have produced a constructive report that clearly shows how to make sure this bill fulfils its radical potential in practice. Supportive comments included those by Dr Callum MacLeod at the University of Edinburgh, who wrote that the committee's scrutiny and report provides a valuable public service in anchoring the bill to land reform as the art of the possible. This bill is bold in its ambition and must be made clear in its detail. We share the government's vision for land reform in Scotland and support many of the measures in the bill and the principles behind them, but the bill needs to be strengthened and clarified to fully deliver the ambitious, radical change many people want to see. Before I go into details, please note that Alec Ferguson dissented from our conclusions on Part 10 relating to agricultural holdings and also to some specific issues in Part 5 on a new community right to buy. And Jim Hume dissented from our conclusions on a right to buy for 1991 Act tenants. Those members will speak for themselves, no doubt. Presiding Officer, many parts of the bill have our full support, subject to recommended improvements, in particular the establishment of both a land rights and responsibility statement and a Scottish Land Commission, which are the most radical departure from past land reform bills. The statement must focus on land as a national asset for the benefit of all of Scotland's people, underpinning this whole process and clearly setting out a fundamental vision for land reform, which is itself rooted in international human rights obligations. Doing this will underpin the Land Commission's work to guide Scotland forward on the land reform journey year by year. However, amendments must ensure that the statement and the Commission's strategic plan and work programme are debated and endorsed in this Parliament. Presiding Officer, we support at least one of the Commissioners to be a Gaelic speaker, as is the case with organisations such as the Crofting Commission and the Scottish Land Court. We strongly support in principle, subject to recommended amendments, both engaging with communities and giving them a right to buy land to further sustainable development. To improve engagement between communities and landowners in Part 4, much more than guidance is required. Local people need to know who a person of significant control is on behalf of landowners. The consequences of non-adherence to this approach must also be spelt out. The introduction of a right to buy to further sustainable development in Part 5 requires the government to clarify if this is intended to empower communities particularly, or is it actually seen as a deterrent to landowners. The proposed tests for communities are set at such a high level that they need amendment, such as Section 47, to turn the only practicable way into the only or most practicable way, and with the definition of harm broadened to include potential impacts on the sustainable development objectives of the community. All agreed that access to information is essential. For many, this is the heart. Yes, certainly.
Liz Smith.
I'm grateful to the member for taking that intervention. He's just mentioned that it's so important about access to information. Was the committee happy with the point that was raised by Sarah Boyack earlier about just how late some of these information points have been given to the Parliament?
With due respect, that has nothing to do with the issues that I'm talking about in the report. We will see the response of the government in due course. Your remarks should be addressed to the government. All agreed that access to information is essential. For many, this is the heart of our current land problems. Evidence shows us the proposals in Part 3 will fail unless they improve transparency and unmask some of the murky ownership models that exist in the world of shell companies, tax havens and trusts. Knowing who owns, controls and benefits from Scotland's land is a basic human right. The evidence underlined in the bill does not go far enough to solve the problem. It must be strengthened so that information can be required rather than requested, and so that anyone in Scotland can ask for that information, as people in other European countries can do at this time. But we need to go even further. We have asked the government to consider several options, including requiring those who want to buy land to be entities registered in the EU, having to provide a Scottish contact point, and being required to name those who will benefit from the ownership of land in Scotland. Part 6 of the bill, which seeks to reintroduce sporting rates, needs far more work. It's fair in principle to tax sporting estates and enterprises, but as the detail emerged, the government's case to see this as a money-raising exercise to boost the land fund was unclear. The government must provide a thorough, robust and evidence-based analysis before the start of Stage 2 to convince us. Current deer management practices in Part 8 are deficient in many areas. It's in the public interest for the bill to strengthen powers by SNH to ensure early action, if found necessary, by a mid-2016 review, without waiting for further legislation to be passed. Briefly.
Dear Beamish.
I thank the member, and would he agree with me that in view of the 2014 report on deer management from SNH that this is even more significant and important?
These reports show a lack of progress, but also the times that the SNH have done deer counts is also lacking, and that has to be amended. Turning to the agricultural holdings aspect, which accounts for around half of the bill, it looks to address hotly debated issues and contested tenancy disputes in many communities for many years. Everyone agrees that we want a thriving tenant farming sector in Scotland. The big question is how we get there. We support the bill's aim to remove barriers to the 1991 Act, tenants buying farms. Force the sale of a farm if a landlord's in breach of the lease, introduce an amnesty for tenants to log improvements they've made, and tighten rules where landlords decide to make improvements to a farm. Presiding Officer, however, other proposals are too often left to secondary legislation, such as changes to the way rent is set, measures to allow tenants to retire with dignity, and for new entrants and young blood to enter the sector. We must have more detail on these provisions before Stage 2 because the annual drain on secure 1991 tenants with moves towards limited duration tenancies fails to ensure tenure security and sustainable agriculture. The majority of the RACI members support giving 1991 Act tenants a conditional right to buy their holding to finally resolve that recurrent problem and move on. As ever, ECHR issues need to be applied proportionately because the long-term reduction in tenancy security is detrimental to human rights. Other issues not currently in the bill should be considered as amendments. For example, the future for small landholders, the often poor condition of tenant farming houses, and the lack of affordable rural housing more widely are intrinsic to a sustainable rural Scotland of which people can live and work. Presiding Officer, many eyes are now on this Parliament to see whether we can deliver the land reform people want to see. I hope that we can match the ambition of the Scottish people and change our relationship with land so that everyone can feel connected with it, involved in the way it's managed, and benefit from its use. The Land Reform Bill is a good start, and we hope that it passes Stage 1 today. However, members across the chamber should realise the scale of the work ahead and the role of international human rights that underpin radical land reform. We cannot ignore the warning by Scottish Land and Estates of huge financial penalties should land reform laws interfere with their entrenched property rights. Is this landowner view legitimate? One witness, presiding officer, human rights lecturer Kirsteen Shields, disagrees. The thrust of this radical bill, the temper of this committee's report, both champion the interests of a fairer Scotland. Ms. Shields puts it succinctly. Is it legitimate to disturb property rights? Is it legitimate not to?
Thanks so much. Now call on Sarah Boyer, up to 9 minutes, please. Ms.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And can I first of all thank the fantastic team who have supported the committee throughout this work, and also the many communities and many witnesses and members of the public and organisations who have given written or oral evidence. That has helped immeasurably in the committee report that we've put together. It is long, but this is a long and complex bill. And I would say it's also a crucial bill. It will have ramifications across the whole of Scotland, and its aims to deliver a more equal country, to tackle concentrated patterns of ownership in Scotland, and to give communities a say in and influence in the use of the land that they depend on, and a fairer balance of power between landlords and tenants. These are worthy aims and objectives, and we support them in Scottish Labour. This bill follows on from the 2003 Land Reform Act and this year's Community Empowerment Act, and it draws on the Land Reform Review Group and Agricultural Holding Group's work. But there is so much more that we need to do to make sure this bill is fit for purpose and delivers on the ambitions that we would support. And that's why I am deeply disappointed we don't have the Scottish Government's response to our Stage 1 report today. We had expected it, and it will impact on our capacity to come forward with amendments over the recess. And I'd actually assumed that this gave the Government a fantastic opportunity to tell their own members how they intend to strengthen the bill in the light of the revolt in the SNP conference in October. So today our job is at least get to the headlines. I would start off by saying the bill must be strengthened in relation to human rights. So we need to see recognition of the International Covenant on Economic and Social Rights and Cultural Rights and the voluntary guidance on the responsible management of tenure fisheries and forests in the context of national food security, underpinning the objectives of this bill. It needs to be on the face of the bill. That will help bolster the purpose of this bill and put the context of human rights in a way that we can debate and reflect on. The Land Rights and Responsibilities Statement is an important start, but it needs to be subject to consultation, and it needs to integrate with biodiversity and climate change issues and be consistent with the Land Use Strategy and the National Planning Framework. We would particularly welcome the new Land Commission, but we'd highlight that they need the skills and experience amongst the commissioners, and not just a range of knowledge, but grounding in the equalities and empowerment challenges that are at the heart of the aspirations in this bill. And the information about control of land and knowledge about land and who owns it and who controls it will be absolutely crucial as to whether this bill delivers transparency and accountability. And that's why we need to know who the request authority is. I think the ministers need to clarify that for us. The Land Reform Policy Review Group gave an important recommendation when they suggested that EU-registered entities would deliver transparency of ownership, and it would deliver the capacity to make sure that taxes are paid where they are due to be paid. Now, that provision is not on the face of the bill, and under questioning, I don't think ministers gave us convincing answers, and certainly today in the chamber we've not had convincing answers about how the bill might change. And I'm sure I'm not the only member who this week has had dozens of emails from constituents wanting that clarity on the face of the bill. So that's something that we need to think about over the next couple of weeks in framing our amendments to make sure the bill does not fail the test of transparency. On page 54, the committee is clear. Clarity of ownership, crucially, who controls ownership and who benefits of ownership. A named person that communities consult and a registration process that's transparent and effective. These are the building blocks we need to see in place. And if ownership is clear and known, then it will be so much easier for communities to be engaged in the crucial decisions relative to the land that they're interested in. And not in every day-to-day decision, the really big decisions. And I think the bill needs to make that more clear. But we need to learn the lessons from the 2003 Act. The guidance is crucial from the Scottish Government. Communities are not going to be able to read the bill.
If it took us 141 pages to come up with our conclusions, the bill is going to be even more difficult. So we picked this up in our visit to Fife. It needs to be made fit for purpose for communities and penalties for lack of engagement. In part five, we strongly support the principle, the new principle in this bill, of a community right to buy land to further sustainable development. It's something we'd hope to see in the Community Empowerment Act, but we welcome it in this bill. Sustainable development is a well-used, well-established term and has featured in several pieces of legislation since the Parliament was established. But there is more detail that could be put into the bill, particularly in relation to how ministers will judge significant harm and significant benefit. We also need to clarify the land that's registered under the Community Empowerment Act and the Land Reform Act to make sure it is all brought together to ensure that communities and landowners have clarity. And a key new provision that I think the committee has rightfully asked for consideration on is the issue about how we deliver good quality land for housing and good quality buildings for housing. An issue raised by the Land Reform Group was not just the idea of a community purchase, compulsory purchase order, but the possibility of a compulsory sale order, where, for example, we have an empty building or vacant or derelict land that could be used to deliver sustainable development, which is not currently being realised. I hope the ministers will look at this issue and consider bringing forward amendment at stage two. It's certainly something we are looking at. It's an area that would definitely help improve the strength of the bill. And it would definitely be something that if the minister is able to work on this over the next couple of weeks, would be a huge improvement. It's supported by Community Land Scotland, Shelter Scotland. If the minister is able to give me a good answer, I'd be delighted to take an intervention.
Minister Aidan MacLeod.
It was just about the point to Sarah Boyack in relation to the compulsory sale orders, that obviously that's work that's been taken forward at the moment through our housing and land reform team. It's part and parcel of the 9 recommendations that were made by the Land Reform Review Group. And I know that there was a lot of consultation that took place over the summer around that. And there was a report that was produced, and ministers are currently considering that at the moment.
But
that was a very helpful intervention, Minister. I'm hoping that you'll now come to the right conclusion in the light of that report. We'd certainly be keen to push this in the amendment stage. In part six, the inclusion of shooting and deer forests on the valuation roll is something that we are absolutely supportive of from the Scottish Labour Party, but we do think there was an awful lot of opposition to this section of the bill, and we think more evidence, particularly in the business regulatory impact assessment, could be provided. And we crucially need to know that local authorities and assessors will have the necessary resources to carry out this piece of work. It's hugely important that it's done fairly, and there are particular concerns about very small holdings, so we need clarification on that. We support the new measures on common good land. They tidy up existing legislation, and accurate mapping of common good land will increase transparency and is definitively a good thing. On deer management, very much support the comments made by the committee convener, Rob Gibson. We do think that there are clearly areas where the system is not working, and while the proposals in the bill will provide some help, it doesn't go far enough, and we do need to see biodiversity problems properly addressed with urgent action, with stronger powers for SNH to act, and that's something we'd like to see in the final version of this bill. Access rights, we think, are important, and the new provisions, again, should help lead to more access and more effective access. I will not be able to do justice, Presiding Officer, to the agricultural holdings section of this bill. It has been extremely difficult to scrutinise this part of the bill because the Scottish Government told us at the outset that they hadn't finished working on these provisions. We are getting, on a not quite a weekly basis, but almost that, more information from the Scottish Government. We support the aim of a vibrant tenanted sector with support for new farmers, with the capacity for long-standing farmers to leave their tenancies with fairness and to have access to good housing. But this requires a great deal of work to be done. We welcome the Tenant Farming Commissioner, but we think that the codes of practice need to be enforced on a statutory basis to deliver fairness across the whole country. I do want to record, Presiding Officer, that we are being drip-fed the government's responses. It's not just that it makes it difficult for us as a committee to consider all these potential amendments, but it's very difficult, I think, for those people who are not in the Parliament to see the full picture. This is complex, it is a hugely important bill, and we do support it, but we think that that problem will actually emerge as a major challenge for us. If I can just say, the government amendments are now due on the 13th of January. Our own amendments are due on the 15th of January, and we have a recess between now and then. We need to make sure this bill is the best bill it can be to deliver for the people of Scotland, and not just to deliver for the people of Scotland, but to be a bill that will stand the test of time. And that's something we need to deliver together. And if the Scottish Government can tell us when they will give us a response to stage one debate, that will help us immeasurably. Thank you very much, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. I now call on Alex Ferguson. 6 minutes, Mr Ferguson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I also begin by thanking the clerking team for the extraordinarily good job they did in bringing this, drawing this report together. Time is very tight, Presiding Officer, so I must come straight to business. But as I look at parts 1 to 9 and 11 of the bill, there is a great deal that we can agree with within them, although it has been extraordinarily difficult to be certain of the full consequences of much of it due to the amount of detail that's been deferred to a future Parliament through secondary legislation. So we don't have any great difficulties with parts 1 to 9 of the bill. Some colleagues will mention some later, or at least their general principles. And any concerns we do have, we will seek to remedy at stage 2 by amendment. And by way of example, under the community's right to buy land in order to further sustainable development, the Minister told us in Dumfries that in a 50-50 situation where the land manager's interests and the community's interests were deemed to be equal, the community's right to buy would override the land manager's interests. Now, I don't agree with that, but it's something that we can and will seek to amend. I do have one exception, however, in these parts of the bill, and that's at part 6, which is the reintroduction of sporting rates. I have a real difficulty that goes beyond the serious concerns that have been highlighted in the committee's report. It was quite clear that the government has not really thought this proposal through, that it has no idea how much it will raise or even cost to raise, that it has no idea how much it wants to raise or even, as became very clear in our Dumfries meeting, really why it wants to raise it at all. The Minister said it was about fairness, and she said it again today, but I struggle to think of to whom this measure would be fair. It's certainly not the many field sports businesses across the south of Scotland, which put millions into the local economy, while competing with similar businesses across the border. If you impose sporting rates on those businesses, you will put some of them out of business. So I agree with the committee that the case for change has not been made, and I really hope the government will heed that. But overall, there's nothing within this, what I call the land reform part of this bill, that would have caused us to vote against the principles of it. It's within part 10 that relates to agricultural holdings that I have a real difficulty, and I want to use my remaining time to explain why, and indeed why we will be voting against this bill this evening. Presiding Officer, I've always believed that this part of the bill should have been a standalone piece of legislation, and I still believe that to be the case. The subject is worthy of deep and meaningful debate, and there exists right now a willingness on all sides of this sector to continue that debate to achieve a long-term sustainable solution to a sector that is beset by a number of problems. The twin aims of the bill are laudable. They are to further empower tenants while creating an environment that encourages those who have land to let it. I have never agreed more with anything that this government has put on paper. But, Presiding Officer, as I've said in dissenting to this section of the bill, this bill cannot achieve those twin aims, and I actually believe that most of my colleagues on the committee would agree with that. What's more, the Stage 2 amendments proposed by the government that would replace the bill's intention to introduce conversion to MLDTs for 91 Act tenants with an assignment for value model will guarantee the exact opposite reaction of those aims, as indeed will the late addition to the committee's report that raises once again the spectre of an absolute right to buy, a right coincidentally consigned to the legislative dustbin by the Cabinet Secretary himself exactly 7 years ago tomorrow. Something is wrong here, Presiding Officer. The Agricultural Holdings Legislation Review Group, chaired by the Cabinet Secretary himself, looked at the assignation for value model and specifically rejected it. Now the Cabinet wants to reintroduce it, and that simply highlights a tragic dilemma that has emerged within this part of the bill. The AHLRG saw the sense of gradually allowing 91 Act tenancies to wither on the vine and be replaced over time with modern, vibrant 21st century letting vehicles. The Cabinet Secretary, in what I can only suppose is a desperate search for his defining legacy, now seems intent on mothballing 91 Act tenancies in perpetuity. And that is exactly why this bill will not create an environment to encourage the letting of land. If he continues down this route, his legacy is more likely to be the killing off of the tenanted sector rather than its reinvigoration. And I don't genuinely believe that that's what he seeks to do. Presiding Officer, has been mentioned, the Rural Affairs Committee and the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee have urged the government to be ultra-cautious with ECHR aspects of this bill. And I want to begin to draw to a close with a warning. We thought we'd passed a competent bill in 2003, and yet all too recently we have seen the tragic consequences of the fact that we did not. And I'm sure anyone involved will have noticed that it was the tenants who have borne the brunt of our mistake. The dangers inherent within this bill's proposals are far greater than they were in 2003, and I would urge the government to scrutinise microscopically the ECHR implications of every aspect of this bill to ensure that it isn't the tenants once again who become its victims. That does not bear thinking about. Presiding Officer, the Cabinet Secretary's legacy could be the man who saved the tenanted sector rather than the man who destroyed it. But the only way to achieve that accolade is to withdraw this section of the bill, accept that more time needs to be given to working on that long-term sustainable solution, and take it up again in the next Parliament. There is a glorious prize to be won, a renewal of trust between landowner and tenant, a truly reinvigorated tenanted sector, and a restoration of the tried, tested and traditional way into agriculture for young and new farmers alike. And the appetite to achieve that is out there. But that prize cannot be achieved through this bill, but I firmly believe it can be achieved, and the time is right. Surely this is worth more than any pre-election headline about landlords and tenants and the passing of an ill-thought-out bill that is more than likely to end up in the European courts. I thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much. I now call on Nigel Dawn on behalf of the DPLR Committee.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I'm grateful for the opportunity to speak this afternoon in my capacity as the convener of the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee. The committee has continuing concerns about the bill. Firstly, I should note the government has latterly provided reassurances that amendments will be lodged at stage two, which will address some of the issues highlighted by the committee. In particular, the committee welcomes the commitment to develop the policy in respect of the power in Section 79 of the Bill regarding conversion of secure 1991 Act tenancies more fully on the face of the Bill. We encourage the Scottish Government to share the amendments proposed with the Parliament as early as possible. The committee, however, remains particularly concerned about two powers within the Bill. Section 35, subsection 1, confers power on Scottish ministers to make regulations enabling persons who are affected by land to access information about persons in control of that land. The committee is concerned about the absence of policy development, which appears to have precluded the inclusion of more detail on the face of the bill and has prevented the committee from being in a position to scrutinise the power fully. The committee recognises that regulations creating a scheme for disclosure of information about individuals are likely to be both substantial and significant. It is not, in the committee's view, appropriate to delegate the development of such a significant policy to regulations. The committee invites the Scottish Government to develop the policy regarding disclosure of information more fully on the face of the bill at stage two. If it's not in a position to do so, then the committee that believes that an enhanced form of affirmative procedure should be attached to that power. Similarly, the committee continues to be concerned about the power in new section 38M of the Agricultural Holdings Scotland Act 2003, inserted into that act by section 81 of the bill. This provides that the Scottish ministers may, by regulations, make further provision about the sale of an agricultural holding in relation to which the Land Court has, under new section 38L, varied an order for sale to allow the holding to be offered for sale on the open market. The power is a significant one, which will permit the process to be set out wholly in regulations. The committee considers that matters with which power to deal should be set out more fully on the face of the bill. This brings me to more general observations about the delegated powers in the bill. Firstly, the committee found much of the information provided by the government in the delegated powers memorandum in oral evidence and in the initial response to the committee's report to be inadequate and insufficient to enable the committee to form a clear view about the purpose and effect of some of the powers. Secondly, the committee remains concerned about the absence of policy development in relation to powers which could interact with individuals' ECHR rights. We are, as a committee, thinking that this approach is wholly unacceptable. The committee considers that policies which may interact significantly with individuals' ECHR rights should be developed in full on the face of the bill rather than deferred to regulations. And finally, the committee reiterates its concerns expressed more recently in relation to the Community Empowerment Scotland Bill that powers are being taken as a substitute for thorough policy development in advance of the introduction of a bill, leaving the committee with framework bills. To conclude, the committee welcomes the intimation from the Minister that amendments will be lodged at stage two to respond to some of the committee's concerns. However, the committee would welcome further reflection on the powers in sections 35 and inserted section 38M of the 2003 Act. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much. And now move to open debate. Invite members who haven't yet pressed the request to speak buttons to do so. Call on Graham Day to be followed by Joanne Lamont. 6 minute speeches, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This bill represents an opportunity to deliver bold and meaningful land reform, but we've got to get the legislation right, right in the public interest, and just as importantly, right for the people who live and work in our rural areas, which in particular will be affected by it. The draft bill was a good start. I think the RACI committee report, influenced by some very helpful contributions from stakeholders, offers worthwhile suggestions on how to build on that. But we are still in the relatively early stages of this process, which offers ample opportunity to better shape the bill. And I want to focus my contribution on a number of areas where there is just such scope. There is virtually unchallenged acceptance of the appropriateness of the people of Scotland having the right to know who owns, controls and derives benefit from land. Indeed, Doug McAdam of Scottish Land and Estates, commenting on circumstances where land ownership is masked by companies or trust, has said, and I quote, "It's crucial a clear point of contact and face of the trust or company is identified, and ideally also the beneficial owner if there is one behind that." So the only debate here, surely, is over how we secure the greatest and most effective degree of transparency. The committee makes a number of recommendations in this regard. Creating a power to require rather than request information and impose sanctions for non-compliance would be one positive step forward. And creating a series of asks within a fit-for-purpose registration process, requiring those who wish to buy land and register title in Scotland to provide a named contact point in Scotland and detail on who will actually control the land and may benefit from that ownership and control. And frankly, any other information that could justifiably be required as part of a registration setup which delivers real transparency and accountability is another. We should and we must push the envelope here. As the report says, the draft bill could also do with being toughened up in the area of deer management. The bill as it stands proposes a set of interim measures which could be deployed should a planned review commenced at the end of 2016 indicate a need for a stringent statutory scheme to be introduced. And it should be acknowledged that the plans around this review are in keeping with the recommendations of the RACI committee and its 2013 report. However, formal and anecdotal evidence left the committee unconvinced that the necessary changes in practice will, at least in some areas, be delivered by the end of 2016. And with Scotland's 2020 biodiversity targets in mind, we cannot take further risk here. Hence the committee calling on the government to ensure the review kicks off within 2016 and certainly within a timeframe which positions the government to take action where it's required come the end of the year. I'm therefore heartened by the Minister's commitment to look at this issue. Those areas where fully functioning deer management plans are in place will have nothing to fear. Those where heels are being dragged need to know they have only months to get their act together. If nothing else, this will focus minds. As Rob Gibson highlighted earlier, we also want the government to amend the bill to arm themselves with the powers that were recommended by the Land Reform Review Group and which could be deployed as necessary at the conclusion of the review. Moving on, the report calls on the Scottish Government to bring forward an amendment to Section 25(2), which lists the codes of practice that may be prepared by the Tenant Farming Commissioner and includes a statutory code of conduct for land agents as a priority. I think other than transparency, if there's one aspect of the report that represents common ground for multiple stakeholders, then this is it. There is not a member of the committee, or indeed probably an MSP representing a rural area, who has not heard horror stories about the actions of some land agents. Can I urge the Minister not only to accept the committee's recommendation, but ensure any amendment leads to the consultation over and implementation of such a code being delivered in timely fashion? If we are ever to improve relationships between landowners and tenants, then getting a grip of those land agents whose approach to their work is hardly conducive to creating a harmonious environment is essential. The committee's report calls for a number of amendments to the draft bill, but just as important, it's calling for greater clarity and information around the regulation-making powers contained within it. Any bill of this size and complexity will contain a significant number of regulation-making powers. We know that. The issue with this one is an absence, at least at this stage, of detail around a number of important provisions which will be left to secondary legislation. I welcome the Minister's commitment to look at this and look forward to receiving a positive response insofar as one can be provided. Similarly, I think our call and that of the DPLR committee for consideration of the nature of the scrutiny processes for these regulations should be heeded. By the time they come before Parliament, we will have had an election and a number of members intimately acquainted with the detail and evolution of the primary legislation will no longer be around to bring their expertise to bear. And just as we need to get the bill right, we need to ensure the related guidance is as it should be. Presiding Officer, I'm conscious of time and looking forward to other contributions. I'll draw my remarks to a close by saying this. Like other members, I suspect I'm counting the hours until the Christmas recess. It's been a tough 6 months going through the Land Reform Bill and the Rural Affairs Committee. However, I'm sure, with my committee colleagues, I look forward to returning to the Land Reform Bill in the next year and helping to ensure it realises its very obvious potential. Thank you.
Thank you much. Now call on Joanne Lamont, to be followed by Angus MacDonald.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I offer my congratulations to the committee for producing what I thought was a very thoughtful and challenging report on what is an issue of importance to people across Scotland. And we only have to look at the passion in the evidence given to the committee to see that it is something that people really care about. And can I also commend the convener of the committee, Rob Gibson, what I thought was a very powerful speech outlining the position of the committee itself. And of course, it's an issue that's very dear to the heart of the Labour Party, and I'm proud of the work that we did in government in making some significant progress in relation to land reform, and I hope that this can build on that work. I think, firstly, it's important to recognise that addressing the significant imbalance of the ownership of land in Scotland is simply an issue of justice. Our history is scarred by the experience of all too many families who were cleared from their land or were denied the opportunity to work the land by those who gave little regard for the consequences for those people. Indeed, I was learning only last night that my own great-grandfather was cleared from his home and dumped on the shoreline on the island of Tyree. And if you look at the census of that time, you can see they did have an impact very immediately on his family. The current concentration of land in the hands of a few gives graphic illustration to the reinforcing impact of inequality in our society, and that's why it should matter. But every bit as importantly, the question of land reform is also an issue about the economy. It's important that communities are able to tackle depopulation from the flow away from too many of our rural and island communities, which was a hallmark of my parents' generation and led to my classroom in Glasgow being full of children from Tyree, Isla, Lewis, Skye and beyond. And we have seen excellent examples of how economic activity has been stimulated through community ownership with a focus on job creation and local enterprises and linking into the great opportunity the internet gives us to allow business to thrive in remote communities. With land concentrated in too few hands, some communities have suffered in the past from benign neglect, with a lack of interest and indifference, which has led to a paralysis in local development. In other cases, there are those who prefer large swathes of our land to be left as a playground for the few, whose interests therefore are in direct conflict with local communities who want jobs and homes for their young people. And it's evident, as I've said, that with community ownership, there is an increased level of activity, of innovation around renewables, for example, and community enterprises. And I would ask the Scottish Government what role they perceive for Community Development Scotland in supporting that focus by local communities. I think it would be significant if we could have that commitment. It is, of course, too essential that accessing the right to buy should not be overly bureaucratic and should have not have a presumption in favour of local communities, given how significant it can be for those communities and for Scotland's diverse economy. And to state the obvious, it cannot simply be they have a theoretical right. It must be one that can be exercised. It is essential that land ownership is transparent. And I note that the committee report says that the bill, quote, should be bold in its ambition and clear in its purpose. This is particularly important on the issue of land ownership, and I do regret that the proposal on transparency have not been followed through. I cannot understand why there is to be an inhibition on who can seek information on who owns land, for example. But it's also a particular regret that the proposals to ensure that legal entities wishing to own land in Scotland should have to be a registered place of business within the European Union. That feels to me to be something very logical if we're going to be able to challenge those who own the land. It should be a fundamental right to know who owns, controls and benefits from the land, and this needs to be addressed, I believe. How can we encourage dialogue between owner and community if we can't even establish who the owner is? In conclusion, I would seek assurance from the Minister and would encourage the Scottish Government to reflect on the potential significance of community land reform in an urban setting. And I say that not simply because our cities are full of the descendants of migrants from the islands and the highlands who reflected in past times failures of the land ownership system. But we also know that in more populated areas, in our towns and our cities, there are problems with land ownership and with land neglect. It can cause blight, it can prevent development and result in lost potential. And so in urging support for this bill, but recognising the challenges still facing the Scottish Government, given the strength of feeling on these issues, I would urge the Government to respond to the committee report, but also to recognise that there is energy and commitment in our urban communities as well as our rural communities that can be harnessed to make sure that land use is more productive for those communities and for our economy as a whole.
Many thanks. And now call on Angus MacDonald to be followed by Tavish Scott. 6 minutes or thereby, please.
Thank you. Thank you, President Officer. It's certainly been quite a journey since June, as we've travelled the length and breadth of the country, taking evidence during stage one, and taking well over 200 submissions of written and oral evidence, which has been extremely helpful in bringing our stage one report to conclusion. However, before I run out of time later, President Officer, which I normally do, can I join the convener and others in paying tribute to the work of the Iraqi Committee clerking team and SPICE, whose help and assistance has been immense. As teams go, they're up there with the best, if not the best, and I look forward to continuing to work with them as we complete stages 2 and 3 of the bill in the coming months. Now, it's clear that the bill has helped to ensure an energising and exciting debate around land reform throughout the country, which will no doubt continue in the next few months and after the bill becomes an act. Because it's clear that while this bill is radical, there simply isn't the time or capacity to address every single issue that needs addressed, which is why the proposal to create a Scottish Land Commission will help move the outstanding issues or any unfinished business forward and will ensure they're not kicked into the long grass but dealt with in a timely manner. On the issue of the Land Commission and the proposal for 6 commissioners, I'm particularly pleased that the committee calls on the Scottish Government to ensure there is a Gaelic speaker amongst them, as Rob Gibson, the committee convener, has already referred to. If this Parliament and the Scottish Government are to show Gaelic the equal respect that has been legislated for in this chamber through the Gaelic Language Act, then they both need to put their money where their mouths are. There's already a legal requirement that there should be a Gaelic speaker on the Crofting Commission and on the Land Court, so to ensure the new Scottish Land Commission has an understanding of the complex history that has left land ownership where it is today in Scotland, I firmly believe it's imperative that the Land Commissioners have the knowledge available to them that will come with a Gaelic speaker. Otherwise, the bill will legislate for a Gaelic name. Yes, certainly.
Minister Aileen MacLeod.
Planning Officer, just to make the point to Angus MacDonald, when he's raising in relation to one of the commissioners being a Gaelic speaker, just to give him reassurance that we too agree. The Scottish Government absolutely recognises the cultural importance of the Gaelic language, and so that's why we've committed to take forward, I think, a Stage 2 amendment. And we very much hope that in the public appointments process that we're able to appoint at least, you know, one commissioner with the required expertise and who's also a Gaelic speaker as well. But that's also been a matter for the Scottish Land Commission.
Thanks, Angus MacDonald.
I very warmly welcome that commitment from the Minister. It gives the Scottish Parliament and the Scottish Government the opportunity to highlight that Gaelic is a living language and that we do show it equal respect. Now, the release of the committee's Stage 1 report a week last Friday at the Registrars of Scotland offices at Meadowbank House coincided with the news that the Park Estate community buyout had reached a successful conclusion, which I'm sure was music to all our ears. It's been 12 long years since the Park Trust was formed and 11 long years since the community agreed to pursue a buyout from a hostile absentee landlord. Now, it's hoped that this bill, when completed at Stage 3, will ensure a situation like the Park buyout saga can never happen again. And of course, the provisions in the bill at Part 5, particularly Sections 38 to 65, introduce a new right to buy land to further sustainable development, which are in addition to the community right to buy and Croftian community right to buy, which are already in place and were recently amended by the Community Empowerment Act, along with the new provisions relating to extending the community right to buy to abandoned or neglected land. However, the proposed new right to buy for communities to further sustainable development contained in the bill is very welcome, but the committee is asking the government to consider whether the test thresholds are too high and whether communities will be able to make full use of the provisions. One aspect of these proposals is that our committee recommends that the Scottish Government considers the benefits of local authorities, other public bodies and or Scottish ministers being able to buy land for present or future community use or as a buyer of last resort, and considers whether the bill could be amended in this regard at stage two. However, it's perhaps worth noting at this point the NFUS's concerns regarding this aspect of the bill until the threshold on community right to buy is properly defined. Turning briefly to Part 6 of the Bill, where the Committee has significant concerns regarding the introduction of non-domestic business rates for shooting and deer forests, throughout the Stage 1 period it became abundantly clear to the Committee that while strongly supporting the principle, there was still a great deal of further detail required, which is why we're calling on the Scottish Government to provide a thorough, robust and evidence-based analysis of the potential economic, social and environmental impacts of ending the sporting rates exemption as soon as possible, and certainly before the start of Stage 2, if the committee is to be in a position to support this part of the bill, which it would clearly like to do. However, there is no doubt in my mind that if removal of the rates exemption was successfully introduced, in addition to raising funds for the Scottish Land Fund and possibly other options such as funding for modern apprenticeship training in rural areas, it will also be another step towards a more balanced rural land market. So, in closing, Presiding Officer, the committee wishes to see the bill strengthened, as I'm sure the Minister and the Scottish Government do. However, it's clear we must be realistic about what can be achieved in the given timetables. As land reform is an ongoing process, what isn't achieved in this bill can be dealt with in the next session of Parliament and by the new land commissioners in the Scottish Land Commission. However, Presiding Officer, this is a good bill, so I'm sure if we all work together with the Scottish Government in the run-up to Stage 2 and beyond to Stage 3, we can make it better. Thank you.
Thanks so much. Now call on Tavish Scott to be followed by Dave Thompson.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Charles Kennedy, in his last speech at a Scottish conference, made a very Charles Kennedy-esque contribution on land reform. I mean, he's missed for many reasons across all of politics, but he was certainly the passionate West Highlander when it came to land reform. And I suspect there'd be much in this bill that he would agree with, as we do on these benches. I have reflected, I was reflecting on Sarah Boyack's point of order and the start of this debate. The Minister said in her opening remarks the bill was complex, and she's entirely right about this. But she also said the bill wasn't being rushed. But I must say, the more I've heard this debate today, my concern about this is that we are rushing an extremely complex piece of legislation. If I heard some of the remarks that the convener of the Delegated Powers Committee made and the convener of the Rural Affairs Committee, not only is this a complex bill, but the government have already said they're going to bring forward profoundly important amendments at Stage 2. And we'll have to see what happens at Stage 3. So from a parliamentary point of view, and Angus MacDonald's absolutely right about what he's just said, the need to scrutinise a major piece of legislation at the tail end of a parliament and to get it right, I think, is a very significant challenge for this parliament indeed. And I do wonder whether or not this debate today shouldn't have been on a motion to take note to allow the debate that the Minister rightly said she wanted to hear, and then for the government to bring forward its Stage 1 debate at the stage that it had provided its full response to the Iraqi committee's very full deliberations, which, as Sarah Boyack was pointing out, run into hundreds of pages and no doubt many tens of recommendations. And I hope the government might slightly reflect on that. Sarah Boyack and Joanne Lamont also mentioned the the land reform that we passed back in 2003, which Jim Wallis, the then Deputy First Minister, took through Parliament. The point that I remember well from that bill was that the bill changed remarkably from its early introduction, in a parliamentary sense, from its introduction all the way through to the Stage 1 debate. And that, I think, reflected well on, particularly on all those who contributed to that debate at that time, who made clear their wish to see aspects strengthened and aspects changed. It also, if I may say so, reflected well on a government who were prepared to listen to that. And I hope this current government will do the same with this complex and challenging legislation. Now, many measures in this bill, as I have suggested, we believe are positive. The transparency around who owns the land that the Minister rightly mentioned, indeed other members have mentioned as well, is profoundly right and should be taken forward in all the right ways. I do get a little concerned by the pretty tired old debate that tends to happen around landowners and who or what they may be. I came across an article in the Scottish Wildlife Trust magazine the other day about Glenfeshey, who, of course, that estate, which is one of the most fantastic parts of Scotland, is owned by Dane Anders Poulsen. He, of course, since 2006, has culled deer, he's regenerated the pine forest, he has made fundamental changes to habitat management and habitat restoration, and is surely, as the SWT put it, an absolute exemplar for all that can be good about both working with our community, working with people who live in that area and who depend on the land, but also doing all the right things for a part of Scotland that is now better than it was before under his stewardship of that substantial part of our country. Yes, of course.
I think that makes a very good point that there are many, many good landowners in the country. I think what we're looking at in the bill is where we don't know who actually does own the land, and it's not possible to have a conversation with those people.
I agree with that point that Sarah Bart made. It's exactly the point I was making about land transparency and the measures that are in the bill, which many of us would like to see strengthened, and that is a very fair observation. I want to just touch on the agricultural holdings aspects to this bill, and as Rob Gibson made clear, it is half the bill. I too share the view that these two things should not, frankly, be lumped together. This is complex legislation. We got it wrong in 2003. All of us who were there will remember it was on a cross-party basis that we got it all wrong. Indeed, there was huge pressure on the government of the day to make that legislative change, and it was supported by all parties. It is a difficult area of law. We can absolutely agree, as Alec Ferguson put it, with the very clear aspiration in the principles of the bill about the vibrancy of the tenanted sector and encouraging and ensuring that there is a greater amount of tenanted land available to let around Scotland. That is as right as it should be. But what we must ensure we don't do is to put tenant farmers through years and years more of complex legal mechanisms that will only benefit lawyers, and whether it be taken down by ECHR, as I think Graham Day was rightly mentioning, or by other legal challenges, I can't think of anything that would be worse for encouraging the tenanted rented sector than this Parliament passing rush legislation, which makes the situation worse than it was before. Now, that will not be the Minister's intention, it won't be the Government's intention, but it is so important that we don't rush the complexity of that issue and simply get it wrong. I was very taken with the group that the Cabinet Secretary chaired to review this era, and I also thought that the appointment of Andrew Thin as the interim, I think he's the interim tenant commissioner, was a very sensible one. Andrew Thin is a substantial figure who has already, with the many groups, made substantial progress on rent reviews, the tenants' improvements, limited partnerships and landlord-tenant obligations. All those issues need to be taken forward in exactly that spirit. And indeed, I saw in the briefing that the NFU proposed, submitted for today's debate, that they recognise the importance of the statutory powers being properly and proactively enforced in this area. So there's great goodwill to make this work, great goodwill to move forward in this area, but I do not and worry about the I worry rather, Presiding Officer, about the Stage 2 amendment that the Minister confirmed the Government is going to bring forward. It seems to me that if we move into some area around right to buy, we will be again bogged down in the courts, and again the only people who will benefit from that will not be tenants but will be lawyers. So this bill is important, and it certainly needs to be properly scrutinised, and the issues that have been raised by many members today lead us to need as much time as this Parliament can give to ensure that scrutiny takes place.
Thanks very much. Now Colin Dave Thompson, to be followed by John Lamont.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I too would like to thank the clerks and the rest of the team in Spice and elsewhere for all the work that they've put in over the past period in relation to this bill. What I would like to do, Presiding Officer, is deal with some of the kind of fundamental issues around the bill and the committee's report. Land, obviously, is a national asset. It has to be used in the public interest and it must be used for the common good. And these are just fundamental things that we must take into account when looking at any land issue. I believe that land reform, this bill, is probably the most important issue that the Parliament has dealt with, certainly in this past session and maybe in its existence. If you actually consider who owns the land, well, let's look at Psalm 24. The earth is the Lord's and everything in it, the world and all who live in it. And if you look at Leviticus, God says, the land shall not be sold forever, for the land is mine, for you are strangers and sojourners with me. Now, what this means is that fundamentally, nobody owns the land but God. Adam and Eve didn't own the land. They were tenants. We are stewards, and we must look after the land. Both theologically and practically, land and community are inextricably linked, and each must benefit the other. So land and community are paramount, and all of society must benefit from the use of land. Of course, much land now is used for hunting, shooting and fishing. And here's what Neil Gunn had to say about the rights of the people in his novel Butcher's Broom. The men also went hunting, the hill for deer and the river for salmon. And so ancient had been their gaming rights that no new laws or restrictions in favour of landlord or lessee could ever convict them in their own minds of poaching. And if poaching it must be called, then so much the greater zest in its pursuit. And again, if you look at Neil Gunn's novel, the reason I'm quoting these things is to put this into a kind of historic context. The Duke of Sutherland, in talking to his good lady wife, said, it really comes to this, that what benefits the landlord benefits the nation. I admit that what has been said by some of your Gaelic enthusiasts has sometimes irritated me. A landlord must have absolute power over tenancy arrangements on his own land. If you cannot, within the law, do what you like with your own, the whole basis of our state is dissolved. I simply will brook no interference in the slightest degree with my absolute ownership of my own lands. And that goes right against the tenancy argument that related to Adam and Eve. Now, fortunately, most landowners don't think like that anymore. But believe you me, there are landowners out there who do think like that. The law which allowed clan chiefs to claim their people's land for themselves was made by the rich and powerful for the rich and powerful. And, of course, I accept there are good landowners. But this legislation is not about good landowners. It's about dealing with the bad ones. And Scottish Land and Estates, has been said earlier on today, is still flexing its muscles and threatening the government with multi-million pound legal threats if we go ahead with this. And, of course, ECHR is an extremely important issue, and this bill must comply with ECHR. There are other things like the International Covenant on Economic, Social and Cultural Rights, which we also have to take account of, and also the UN Voluntary Guidelines on Responsible Governance of Tenure of Land, Fisheries and Forests in the content of the National Food Strategy. This Land Reform Bill is dealing with a complex issue. There's no doubt about that. And in my local paper, or one of them, the West Highland Free Press, the editor seemed to think or doubt that the Scottish Government was committed to any kind of radical land reform at all. Well, this is a radical bill. The Land Commission, once it's created, will be looking at land issues day in, day out, week in, week out, month in, month out, forevermore. And registration of land will ensure we know who owns the land. Just briefly thank the Minister for comments about a Gaelic-speaking commissioner. Just put this picture in your mind. If the six land commissioners, including the tenant farmer commissioner, were all Gaelic-speaking crofters from Sutherland, or indeed were all merchant bankers from Edinburgh, which land commission do you think would do the best job for the people of Scotland? Finally, Presiding Officer, we do need to deal with a conditional right to buy for 1991 secure tenants. We need to give them the opportunity, because this is a boil that needs to be lanced. There could well be conditions with a prescribed time frame, a choice to sell the holding to the landlord if the tenant wished, the choice to accept a lower value with a lifetime tenancy to, say, age 65, and also a right of preemption for the land in favour of the land owner should the tenancy be sold on. This is a debate we need to have. We need to deal with this issue. If we don't deal with it, it's going to sour the whole thing as we move forward.
Thanks so much. Now call on John Lamont to be followed by Rhoda Grant.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to be able to speak today on the significant bill which Parliament has been considering. The bill introduces a whole range of new proposals, many of which are commendable in their aims, but some of which are ill thought out and potentially damaging to jobs, to farming and to the right to own property. It is because of this that my party will not be supporting this bill at stage one. It is our belief that the Scottish Government needs to go back and think again on land reform. There are a number of provisions in this bill which would not be in the interest of landowners or communities in the borders in my constituency. Part 6, which would reintroduce business rates for shooting and deer forests, the vast majority of which run at a loss, will inevitably cost jobs in my constituency. Reintroducing rates could also have the perverse effect of ensuring that shooting is only carried out on large estates, resulting in poorer land maintenance and a rise in deer populations. In the borders, the estates will be put at a competitive disadvantage to those across the border in North Northumberland, meaning jobs will certainly be lost. Unusually for an SNP-dominated parliament, the committee report notes that the case for change in this area has not been made. Presiding Officer, this Scottish Government appears too quick to stereotype landowners as wealthy individuals who are not working in the interests of local communities or the land they own. As the NFUS put it, the them and us attitude is not an accurate portrait. The reality is that they are more often than not hard-working stewards of the land who contribute to tourism, employment and housing. And the most worrying example of this view is in Part 5 of the bill, which would allow the Scottish Government to force landowners to sell their land if ministers decide they are not using it in the way that they wish. I accept that the bill would allow this provision only to be used to further sustainable development and only when significant harm was identified to the community if the land was not transferred, coupled with significant benefit to the community if the land is transferred. However, the bill defines neither sustainable development nor significant benefit or harm. The problem with this is the right to buy is potentially very wide-ranging to a much greater extent than existing rights to buy, and MSPs are therefore being asked to approve them in principle without knowing how they would work in practice. And, Presiding Officer, these provisions clearly interact with the European Convention of Human Rights, most notably the right to peaceful enjoyment of possession. The Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee has said they were, and I quote, unable to confirm to Parliament whether these powers are to be exercised in a manner that is compatible with ECHR. The report noted this is a matter of concern to the committee, and it should be a matter of concern to all of us here today. I am concerned that these provisions are rooted in SNP ideology that the state knows best, but at the very least, there are clearly questions to be answered over whether these provisions are proportionate and therefore legal. No one in this chamber wants this legislation to be challenged in the courts, which is currently drafted, and currently drafted is a very real possibility. Mr. Allard, want to take
the
Thank the member for taking an intervention. He was talking about the rest of Europe. Does he know that we had a committee? I'm a substitute on a committee. We had at committee level that France, for example, have got a system like SAFER, which controls very, very much the sale of any kind of land, and it's a lot stricter than what is proposed in this bill.
Well, I'm not familiar with that particular French Act of Parliament. What we are considering today, the concerns that have been raised by the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee, are concerns that we need to take on board. And I would suggest the Scottish Government needs to reflect on the bill and ensure that it's amended to ensure there is no issue about compatibility with ECHR. Now, there are other areas of concern over Part 5 of the bill. For example, it's unclear whether the intention behind these provisions are to act as a deterrent to any landowners currently causing significant harm, or rather is to empower communities by providing real estate ownership opportunities. As the Stage 1 report puts it, it would not be appropriate for government officials to provide advice to third parties seeking to exercise this new right to buy, as well as processing and then deciding on applications. Presiding officer, some of the intentions behind this bill my party fully agrees with, but in too many cases the Stage 1 report concludes that the bill in fact fails to achieve many of its aims. Firstly, the provisions designed to improve the transparency of land ownership, something I agree which needs to be tackled, does, according to the committee, unlikely to deliver the improved transparency about those who not only own land but control or benefit from land that the Scottish Government is seeking. And Part 10, to which my colleague Alex Ferguson dissented, will not only fail to meet the stated aims of this bill, they will make things worse. The bill seeks to reinforce the rights of tenants while encouraging people with land to let their property. There are defects in the current Acts of Parliament governing this, but the complex changes proposed by this bill will not diversify land tenure. And again, concerns were raised by witnesses and the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee that too much in this part of the bill was being left to secondary legislation. When the committee visited the Scottish borders, it was this part which dominated discussions. The Cabinet Secretary has admitted that he is limited in terms of amendments due to time constraints. I cannot support a bad piece of legislation which will make an already complex area of the law even worse. At the very least, this part of the bill should be taken out and improved. Presiding officer, this legislation is far from satisfactory. Perhaps because it tries to do too much, it fails to achieve so many of its aims. And because of the damaging proposals over a new right to buy, the reintroduction of rates for sporting estates, and the problems surrounding the sections concerning agricultural holdings, my party will be unable to support this bill at Stage 1. Thank you.
Thanks so much. Now Colin Rhoda-Grant to be followed by Alison Johnson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Land reform is unfinished business, and this bill won't be the last word. We sometimes appear to have come a long way since the Ascent Crofters struggled to buy their land. But as Angus MacDonald said earlier this month, the park community in Lewis bought their estate, and this followed a 13-year struggle, despite legislation that was supposed to make that easier for them. And it was only due to their perseverance that they achieved that goal. Many other communities would have given up years ago. We need to make sure that when we're bringing forward new legislation, we're not putting new barriers in front of communities seeking to buy their land. There's many natural barriers already. For instance, you need a majority of the community to agree, and anyone who works with communities will know that having that level of agreement is difficult, almost impossible. It only happens when the current situation is untenable. Similarly, people don't want the responsibility of managing an estate. If the estate is being well run and managed currently, why would you? There would be no community benefit and no advantage. And finally, in order to carry forward such a plan, you need strong community leaders with staying power. Many communities that would benefit from owning their own land simply don't have the leadership, and it never progresses. You need a number of people with knowledge and stamina to lead a buyout, and they also need to keep their community with them every step of the way. Therefore, I would argue that there are natural checks and balances in the system without adding others. Obviously, a buyout needs to be in the public interest, and it must have the goal of sustainable economic development. The bill before us today should not make this harder. In the Highlands and Islands, the land reform movement is of particular importance because history tells us of the clearances and of the land raids. The fight against poverty, the fight for equality, has always come down to who owns the land and who has the right to work it.
And that still resonates today, possibly because of our history, people having been driven off the land or into poverty, as Joanne Lamont said, being moved to the poorer land at the shore because of others' lack of concern for their work and their well-being. And sadly, we see that still happening today. Less so in the Croft and Counties, where people have the right to their crofts and a degree of security. However, many of those scenarios are still played out in farming tenancies. They desperately need security and the right to have a say over their own destiny, and it's true for all who work in the land. We must right the wrongs of the past. Clearances appear like ancient history until you look round your communities and see many are still struggling to survive because of the clearances. If you walk through many Highland glens, you'll come across ruins of villages that were once vibrant communities. We really need people to return to these glens. There are powers to create new crofts, but that has stalled. How can we build our economy and improve our services without people? The land reform goes much wider than simply the land. The land is a driver for the well-being of our communities. It's an economic driver, one of our prime resources. Where it's being managed for the benefit of the community, we see communities flourish and grow. Where it's not, we see them wither and fail. Depopulation has haunted the Highlands and Islands since the clearances, and I hope this bill will help. However, given the new Land Commission and HIE power to address depopulation and indeed repopulation might go a long way to righting those past wrongs. People living and working on the land should also know who that land belongs to. Far too often, estates are owned by faceless companies or a string of companies, and it's impossible to know who you should turn to when you need to make improvements or changes. Offshore companies often holding sway with no accountability at all. The bill looks at who should own land and how transparent that owner should be. People have a right to know who owns the land that they work. Back when we considered the Land Registration Scotland Bill, there was an opportunity to include the need for a register of beneficial owners in that bill. But sadly, the government defeated that amendment. And that said, I welcome the change of heart. I suspect it's in some way due to the Minister's intervention, and I very much welcome that she has taken that stance. I can't understand why such transparency would be a problem. We need to strengthen this part of the bill. When you go and open a bank account, you have to prove who you are, that you will not use it for fraudulent purposes and the like. Anyone who's opened one recently will know the hoops you have to jump through. Land is an asset. It's often a currency in which people hold their wealth. They receive tax breaks and the like. Surely the same checks and balances must be required when you are buying an estate. A number of speakers have spoken about ECHR. An individual's human rights is always secondary to the human rights of wider society. I firmly believe that ECHR is not a barrier to land reform. In fact, it's a driver to land reform, taking account of the wider human rights of our communities. Presiding Officer, I welcome the bill. I hope it will be greatly strengthened at stage two, because if it is, parts of the country that have been ignored for far too long will be empowered to build their own futures. That will not only be a benefit to them, it'll be a benefit to all of us.
Many thanks. I now call on Alison Johnson to be followed by Mike Russell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. But before I begin, I'd like to say that I too agree with colleagues who would have liked to have seen the government's response to the bill. And I just wonder in future if we could look at dates, have a bit more liaison and make sure that does happen in future. Land is limited. It's also emotional and personal. Our homes are on land. We live off the land. Nations are defined by their land. We all need land, but access to it and ownership of it is unequal. The land inequity we see today in Scotland is vast and totally out of step with many of our European neighbours. Patterns of land ownership in our neighbouring nations are typically 1,000 times less concentrated than in Scotland. And not only do relatively few people own most of Scotland, but around a quarter of all estates over 1,000 acres have been held by the same families for over 400 years. So this is the history we live with today, and which this Parliament is slowly beginning to overcome. Land reform as we hear, is a broad topic. It's rural and urban, but it also concerns the marine environment. It's inextricably linked to local democracy, fiscal policy, land prices and human rights. Scottish Greens have always seen radical land reform as a vital element of the journey to a more sustainable, equal and prosperous Scotland. I hope that this bill is the start of the Parliament taking a renewed and sustained interest, be this through greater devolution, empowering local authorities through tax reform, or community empowerment. In this bill, the provisions on transparency are important. Who owns and benefits from land is a key question, and I believe the electorate are entitled to full transparency about who really owns Scotland. Now, there's no simple way to deliver complete transparency, but unfortunately, what the government proposes is unworkable. It limits those who can make requests under Section 35 and contains no measures in Section 36 to compel any company in, for example, Grand Cayman, to reveal anything at all about who is in control of it. It's unenforceable, and it will continue to allow Scottish land ownership to be involved in complex schemes of tax avoidance and evasion and secrecy. The best option on the table by far is to allow only EU-registered companies to own land, and we welcome the committee's recommendations on this point. Fiscal reform also is a core part of land reform. I fully support bringing shootings and deer forests back onto the valuation roll. Of course, no one likes to pay tax, especially if it's a tax that they've had an exemption from. But there is more than enough evidence that this should occur. As Andy Whiteman, land reform expert, puts it, why should caravan sites, pubs and local shops subsidise those who occupy shootings and deer forests? The hair salon, the village garage, they're subject to rating, and deer forests and shootings pay nothing. The Land Reform Review Group made it clear that there is no clear public interest case in maintaining the current universal exemption of agriculture, forestry and other land-based businesses from non-domestic rates. Conclusions from the House of Commons Scottish Affairs Committee report this year also raised similar concern, that the exemptions are not having the desired impact and that these exemptions should be open to the same level of scrutiny as other government spending, that they could in fact be pushing land prices up and undermining the Scottish Government's commitment to increasing land and community ownership. Bold land reform is needed for Scotland, and this can help deliver more affordable homes. Current rates exemptions for vacant and derelict land and for empty industrial buildings both incentivise land in urban areas to stay vacant, and all of this land could be used for homes for people. There's almost 11,000 hectares of derelict and urban land vacant in Scotland, and a massive demand for affordable homes.
Jamie McGregor.
I thank the member for taking the intervention. The point she makes about sporting rates in relation to garages is odd to me, because whereas sporting rates will pay are going to be levied in Scotland as an extra tax, there is no extra tax on garages.
Alison Johnston.
I'm sure the member will agree that when we have a situation, for example, where the King of Dubai, who's the Prime Minister of the UAE, is paying absolutely nothing, and a local caravan site is paying some £12,000 a year, there is a massive discrepancy. I simply do not see the case that some local businesses are subject to NDR and shooting estates and the like are not. Where was I? No, I was actually speaking about vacant land in Scotland, and the fact that we have so much of it, it's untaxed, and we have massive problems with homelessness. We heard earlier today that there are 54,000 homeless households in Scotland. And what about the deplorable situation Andrew Stodder and his family found themselves in? This has brought tenant farming rights up the agenda again, and rightly so. It was clear that poor housing issues jumped out during Raki's evidence gathering. And I learned that homes under agricultural tenancies are exempt from minimum standard. There are clearly improvements to be made here, and I support the calls for a right to buy for tenants in specific circumstances. And I'd like to, in closing, flag up a couple of things that Scottish Greens think should be included in the bill. There are numerous examples of common land not on the register passing quietly into private ownership. We should create a new protective order for land without an identifiable owner, and this should require the keeper to conduct a public consultation to help ascertain the true legal status of the land well before any title is registered. And finally, we have left on the statute book a piece of legislation called the Division of Commonties Act 1695. It was one of the legal tools used to privatise vast tracts of common land. This law should be repealed to protect the few patches of common land that remain, to signal our break from the land grabs of the past. Please. We will support the bill today, but there is much to be done before stage two. Thank you.
Thanks. Now call on Mike Russell to be followed by Jamie McGregor.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm very pleased to have the opportunity to contribute to this debate and, as a member of the committee, help shape what is a good bill into an even better piece of legislation. And I want to assure the Minister that she has a strong support on these benches and indeed outside the chamber in the task that she has said she is undertaking to do that. And it can be done. The bill is complex and wide-ranging. I haven't time to touch on every single issue in it, and I want to associate myself with much that the convener has said about the key issues. But I just want to mention the issue of transparency. I'm old enough to remember the groundbreaking work of John McEwen, who died in 1992 at the age of 104, who devoted his whole life to asking the question, who owns Scotland? And he and many others who have pursued that aim would be incredulous if a Scottish Parliament, which did not even exist when he lived, did not answer that question and answer it fully. That question must be answered. But the key overriding intent of this bill is to redefine the relationship of the people of Scotland with their land. And that task has to rest upon the four founding principles of this Parliament, Presiding Officer. Our approach to land needs to be accessible, accountable, based on equality, and it must further the sharing of power. It is vitally important that the Parliament accepts that the rights of property are not the only rights that can be exercised or are legally enforceable in 21st century Scotland. And it's then important that the Parliament takes steps to make that acceptance real and effective. The convener quoted Kirsteen Shields, writing in The Spectator some weeks ago. She pointed out that there is a political and legal obligation on the Scottish Government to pursue land reform as a human rights measure. Human rights issues aren't peripheral to this bill, they're central to them. They're the reason for moving forward, and they must be embedded in the work of the Land Commission. Land's an asset for the whole of Scotland, not just for those who are wealthy enough to buy it or lucky enough to inherit it. The people have a right to benefit from Scotland's land. And communities and individuals must be able to enforce those rights, which must include the right to be consulted. I have constituents in Carrick Castle, down in Loch Goyle, in my constituency, who know that only too well. The planning laws itself hasn't been able to protect them from an individual who's bought 12 and a half square miles of land, is building what appears to be a hunting lodge, and hasn't asked anybody for permission, except the National Park. The community have been ignored. So parts 1 and 4 of this bill have to be strengthened to ensure that such abuse cannot and does not happen in 21st century Scotland. And in part 4, as the Minister knows, the language of the policy memorandum needs to come onto the face of the bill to prevent landlords, including state landlords, including local authorities, refusing to ask and refusing to listen. Secondly, Presiding Officer, communities must be able to obtain land from those who either do not wish to work with their fellow citizens or are not using the land to benefit their good. I very much welcome the Minister's comment today in response to Sarah Boyack on the issue of a compulsory sale order. I'm glad it's being considered. There are circumstances, they may be few in number, but there are circumstances where a minister should be able to order the sale of a property to a community. Thirdly, deer management requires urgent action, and Part 8 needs to be imbued with a much greater sense of determination, as do the actions of SNH. I was the minister who started off the merger between the Deer Commission with SNH, and frankly, I expected better of it. In reality, and this is SNH's own admission, no one knows how many deer there are in Scotland. And in many places, no proper counts have taken place for a decade or more. If a third of the deer population is not culled every year, then the size of the herd will increase. That leads to environmental degradation, but is also cruel to the animals themselves. It's unconscionable that it's being done as deliberate policy. It's intolerable if it's merely as a result of incompetence and a system that doesn't work. There is a need to take legislative action, in my view, sooner rather than later. Tying the matter to environmental sustainability would be a good start, as the Scottish Wildlife Trust has suggested. And finally, Presiding Officer, the tenancy proposals are moving in the right way, but they still give too much power to the landowner and too little to the tenant. I very much support the Cabinet Secretary in his desire for stability in the tenanted sector, but he knows I'm sceptical regarding the ability to secure in a single bill both means to increase tenants' rights and to inculcate new confidence in those that let land. I therefore believe, and it's not the view of the committee, but it's my own belief, that the state in the end will have to intervene to make land available for tenanting, as indeed was the case in the 1948 Act. And that's presently out with the scope of the bill, but I do think it's something the Land Commission will in the end have to consider. But it is necessary now to come to a conclusion about the right to buy for 1991 tenants. It's not good enough for the Law Society to dismiss the issue as one which should never be raised again, as they did in their briefing for this debate. It is a core matter for many of my constituents in places such as Isla of Bute. It's not an issue of lofty legal abstraction. It won't go away, and it has to be resolved. And the bill should also tackle the plight of the small landholders, whose situation has not yet been rectified, despite attempts to use crofting law, and whose rents in places like Arran are being raised again. Finally, Presiding Officer, although there are many other things that might be and will be discussed here today, there's an overriding imperative we must all remember as this bill moves, I hope, to its next stage. The issues of the bill are certainly emotive for some, but they're emotive because they're about how people not only earn their living, but how they live and how they have lived. And Scotland will be the richer if we engage more and more people in the issue of land and its relationship to our collective future. We'll also be the stronger if we ensure that our legislation recognises that rights are about more than money and that equality and equity need to be embedded. The bill is a good attempt to take these matters further. With the help of many outside this chamber and inside, we can take those steps and do something worthy of our country in the 21st century.
Thank you. If members keep to the 6 minutes, I might be able to call everyone. Jamie McGregor to be followed by Hans Alamalik.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. I refer members to my agricultural interests in the Register of Members' Interests. Now, I thank those organisations for their briefings in advance of today and colleagues on the RACI committee for their Stage 1 report. I draw the Parliament's attention to the National Farmers' Union of Scotland briefing, which states that any land reform must focus on what is done with the land rather than who owns it. I also concur with Alex Ferguson about the need to revisit the agricultural holdings section out with this bill because, as drafted, it cannot achieve the twin aims of reinvigorating the tenanted sector while creating an availability of land if it is encouraging an environment that discourages the amount of land available. Now, there's been a lot of rhetoric from the Scottish Government, and I want to start by putting two basic facts on the record. Fact one: private landowners currently contribute significantly to the Scottish economy, as economic studies have shown. And there are many examples of good practice and significant investments being made which are helping to sustain jobs, provide affordable rural housing, and boost economic growth in often fragile and remote rural communities. And all of us should welcome this. Fact two: the costs of maintaining land and estates in good order are very significant. Drainage, fencing, upkeep of buildings, agriculture and domestic cross-compliance issues, to name just a few, are all practical costs. And in many cases, these costs would fall on the public purse if ownership was transferred from individuals. And this must be factored into any decisions on land tenure where there is such a pressure already on public expenditure. This is surely a very serious consideration. Well, quickly.
Rob Gibbs.
You say that if the land was taken over by communities, that the support of it might fall on the public purse. Isn't it the case that many private landowners rely on the public purse in order to maintain their land right now?
Jim McGregor.
Well, it's true, Mr Gibson said, that landowners receive EU subsidies to do with agriculture. That is true. The Scottish Conservatives are clear that community ownership does play a positive part in terms of land management. Again, there are some good examples, but so too does private land ownership. It was, of course, the Conservative government in 1974 who introduced the Land Tenure Reform Scotland Act, and in the 1990s we introduced the Transfer of Crofting Estates Scotland Act. At the highly successful Future of Crofting Conference, which I helped to convene with Jean Urquhart in Inverness last weekend, I saw famous Scottish author and land reform expert, Professor Jim Hunter, who told me that the Conservative government's record on land reform was better than that of any other party. And I thought it was good of a man, who may not be a natural Conservative, to speak so frankly and truthfully and give credit where credit is due. We are also supportive of proposals in Part 4 of the bill to increase community engagement, which provides benefit for everyone concerned, and look to the Scottish Government to produce appropriate guidance on this. But I do share concerns expressed in relation to aspects of Part 5 around community right to buy. It is to be regretted that this risks stopping investment from estates and that these provisions could impact on landowners who already manage their land well, whether through agriculture, forestry, sporting, or any other land-based activity. Ministers have said good landowners have nothing to fear, but this is contradicted in relation to the sustainable development intervention powers, and the Scottish Government needs to look hard at this problem and address the concerns. I also support the comments made by Alex Ferguson about the potential impact on individuals' ECHR rights. We're all aware that with the Salveson-related claims, we are in the midst of the fallout of a previous breaching of ECHR as a result of previous land reform legislation. How does the Scottish Government think the compensation bill, how much is the bill going to be for settling these claims, and what assessment have the ministers made of the cost of future compensation claims if certain provisions in the bill are passed as they stand, or indeed if they are taken further? On Part 6, the reintroduction of non-domestic rates for shooting, I have serious concerns that this extra tax is a retrograde step that can only lessen the viability of enterprises by making them non-competitive with those across the border. And they employ people in some of our most under-pressure rural communities. And by doing this, the government may drive away a very important land activity to the rural economy, resulting in unemployment and less money to the Scottish Government. I welcome the RACI Committee's call for the Scottish Government to provide a thorough analysis on this. And on the deer management proposals in Part 1, I wish to flag up concerns among deer managers about the suggestion that even greater powers should go to SNH to allow them to set cull targets. Deer management is by its very nature a ground-up approach, and a top-down approach runs contrary to the nature of deer management with its cross-sectoral collaboration. And I can't leave land reform without mentioning the Scottish Gamekeeper's excellent document, A View for Moorland, A Future for Moorland in Scotland, there it is, the need for a locational strategy. I implore the Scottish Government to study this remarkable document in detail, since it contains so much practical and scientific knowledge on Scotland's open moorland, which makes up such a huge area of our land, over half of our country, in fact. In order that we can make the most of this unique asset, which Scotland is lucky enough to possess, after all, a Scottish forestry strategy. There should shortly also be a Scottish moorland strategy by the Scottish Government. Thank you very much.
Many thanks. I now call Hans Alamalik to be followed by Jean Urquhart.
Thank you very much and good evening, Presiding Officer. It is a pleasure to talk about Land Reform Bill today. The Labour Party paved the way for radical reform of land ownership and delivered the first phase of the reform. Now Scotland is getting ready for the next phase of the reform. With a shaky start, I have to say, and I do wish them well to get to grips with it. I hope the Minister's hearing my good wishes. She's too busy in conversation.
I'm afraid I don't think that the Minister is listening since they are chatting. Mr. Malik, please continue.
I will repeat for her benefit. I was wishing her well to get to grips with the reform. I know that she's very keen to try and do a good job on it. In order to build upon what has been done in Scotland and other countries,
Minister.
To thank the member for his comments and just to say we're just clarifying something with the Rural Affairs Secretary.
Hanzala Malik.
That's fine, thank you. In order to build upon what has been done in Scotland and other countries, we need to look closely at both policy and practice in recent years. Since the first set of reforms in Scotland, the debate has developed and issues of human rights, the environment, and transparency of ownership have become increasingly important. And why not? I think they are all equally important. Land reform is not just about the ownership of land, but also about how it is used. We must strive to get a balance between land rights and responsibilities, between the rights of tenants and the landlords and their landlords. The Scottish Parliament's Rural Affairs, Climate and Change of Environment Committee reported on the Land Reform Bill Scotland states that reforms should firmly be set within the complex of international human rights obligations. I believe this is very important. I agree with the suggestion by the Scottish Environmental Link that many final stages should have full definitions of what is meant by terms such as community, community assets, and sustainable development of land and land reforms. This is important for the bill to become a comprehensive and comprehensive statement of policy and be a meaningful challenge. Other important point is that if the reforms are to be meaningful, the thrust for the proposal, new rights to buy for communities must have the opportunity to further stability and development. I would like to support the committee's query asking the government to consider whether the test thresholds are too high and whether communities will be able to make full use of this provision. There is no point in giving enablement legislation if they cannot be used in practice. I have experienced land and land reforms in different countries. It is a minefield, so much confusion, particularly land which has shareholders, must be very clearly defined in terms of ownership as well as value, because there is nothing worse than land disputes destroying families as well as businesses. So I know for a fact that Nicola Sturgeon, our now First Minister, was very keen to see this bill brought forward and delivered for the people of Scotland. However, I do notice that the sharing of information has been very, very slow, and I also feel that the government has let not itself down, not Nicola Sturgeon down, but the people of Scotland down with sharing this information far too late. I genuinely believe, and I understand it's difficult. I'm not trying to criticise the minister, but I have to say that the team has let her down, because I know the minister personally, who's been very active in other committees, and it is not like her whatsoever. I'm just hoping that we can get more information before the recess so that people can have a better study of what is being proposed, because I think it's very important. This is something that a lot of countries have grappled with. It's not easy, I appreciate that, and I give that to the minister. But I think that sharing of information at this early stage is very important, because we need to get this right. There is nothing more worse than rushing it at the last minute. So I look forward, and I wish the minister well, and I look forward to getting the information as soon as so that we can all actually have a better look at that, because I think delivering the right policies for the people of Scotland is very important, and I'm sure the minister herself would want to see that happen as well. Thank you very much.
Many thanks. I now call Jean Urquhart to be followed by Christian Allard.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I would like to recommend a book that everybody should read to better understand the passion with which we should deal with land reform, and that's Tom Johnson, the best Secretary of State for Scotland that we ever had, and his book, Our Scots Noble Families, where we really know how the land was acquired by some of the landowners who are still there today. There's no doubt that that the Act in 2003 was welcome, and it has only, I think, kind of fed the desire for more and better legislation around land reform. I won't go over some of the issues that have been covered already by others, and in particular some of the Highland estates referred to by Rhoda Grant and how they came about. But I would like to challenge perhaps John Lamont's point about that it's the people who own the land who know best how to work the land. And he said it's not the case. In defence of land ownership, he said the state doesn't know best. Well, I would suggest that nothing that we're talking about is about the state knowing best, but it is in fact about the people who live on the land and the communities that are there who really do know best. And the evidence is, it's really there for all of us to see. I mean, less than 2 weeks ago, Park Estate actually achieved ownership of their 28,000 acres. And I have no doubt that they will follow Egg and Ascent and Anstoris Uist in showing that there, more and more people will live there, more and more jobs will be created, and they can benefit the people who live there and the communities far more than an absentee landowner that was the situation they had until 2 weeks ago. I think we should celebrate the fact that they have achieved that 13 years it's taken them to own the land. And if this Land Reform Act means that no other community has to go through that, then bring it on. But in addition, I'd really like to highlight the absence. Yes.
Jamie McGregor.
I thank the member for taking intervention. We've had two acts on crofting in this Parliament, which really haven't delivered very much for the crofters. I think she might agree with that. Will she make certain, or try to make the government certain, that this act will deliver for tenant farmers?
Jean Urquhart.
Well, I thank Jamie McGregor for raising that issue, because here we have a ludicrous situation where somebody who can own 28,000 acres in Lewis is not required to meet any of the regulation that somebody who owns 20 acres in Shetland or anywhere else does. So let's, you know, really we have to look at exactly what we're asking for here. Of course we have argued about the Crofting Act, and of course it needs, the whole thing needs to be renewed, but that's not what we're arguing about in this potential bill. I would like to look at tax havens, though, and the link between corruption, offshore corporate property and land ownership. It's clearly established in a recent Transparency International report that land owned in offshore jurisdictions such as the British Virgin Islands, Jersey and Guernsey is particularly common in London, and 75% of properties under investigation for corruption are using offshore ownership to hide their identities. But the problem isn't confined to South East England. Another investigation recently found that as much as 750,000 acres in Scotland, most of it in Highland estates, are owned in offshore tax havens. This is a disgrace, and it makes it potentially impossible to find the real owners, as there can be a series of shell companies and trusts, particularly if they are registered in those offshore secrecy jurisdictions. The legal means to reveal ownership are not available. Consequently, the review group made a strong recommendation to tackle the problem. The review group recommends that the Scottish Government should make it incompetent for any legal entity not registered in a member state of the European Union to register title to land in the Land Register of Scotland, and to improve traceability and accountability in the public interest. I think that that is an issue that many would like to see. Andy Whiteman, of course, has been a long campaigner to highlight these issues, and he's clearly having a success, as is the government, in raising the issue around land reform. I know that other members will be the same. I had over 200 people email me around this debate today. So there is an interest, and it is the mass of people who've responded to the consultation too. It's individuals who recognise the injustice. As late as the mid-80s, we paid a feudal due, a feudal tax, to our feudal landlord on a very small bit of land in Ullapool. I think I'm right in saying that something like 400 years before that, England had stopped being a feudal country. This Act is long overdue. Change is desperately needed. People must be able to access the land. The Stoddart family have been cited. There's a school in Northwest Sutherland, presiding officer, that sits in the middle of a loch. And that was, I thought it was quite romantic that it was there, but it's there because the then landowner refused to give them land. And when he was pressed by the council and forced that there could be a compulsory purchase order, he offered the loch.
I'm afraid you must close, or I can't call Ms. Shirala.
I'm just saying there are many wrongs to be righted, and this bill is welcome as the first step in that long road. Thank you.
Many thanks. And to now call Krishna Lad, around 4 minutes or so, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Very much appreciated. I welcome the Land Reform Bill, and it's, I shall repeat it, about fairness, equality and social justice. And that point of social justice has very much been used by a lot of the contributions so far, and our relations, I think, it's what it's all about. And let me tell Mr. John Lamont, who was very kind enough to take an interruption for me, that we need this kind of radical reform to bring us, to update us, to what our European neighbours are, in which place they are already regarding land use and land reform. It's very, very important that this legislation is seen as something to update Scotland to the 21st century. I spoke about safer in France, for example, and I will encourage the members to look at the system of safer in France and how it works. And you'd be surprised, it's a lot stricter, a land arbitrator that is proposed in this bill. I do welcome the establishment of a tenant farming commissioner, and I think that has been welcomed by all sides. And that should be enough. I think it should be enough to create that level playing field between tenants and landowners. However, we are in a journey with this land reform bill, and my plea to all involved in land ownership and tenancy is to make it work. As a substitute of the committee, I participated to some of the deliberation of the evidence gathering, but I didn't participate to the writing of this report. And I have to thank the committee for this fantastic, for a very, very big piece, a lot of pages to go through, and I've got to admit I didn't go through all of them, Presiding Officer. But I do disagree with one point. I thought I didn't find any recommendation in it regarding the update of the role of common good land. And I would have thought that would have been a perfect opportunity to do so. And I know, as the Minister will say, as the Cabinet Secretary closing will say, as the Community Empowerment Bill dealt with identifying common good land and the disposing of it. But it's exactly that, Presiding Officer. It's identifying it and the disposing of it. What's missing is how to acquire more of it. And I didn't share some of the evidence from one particular, and I will not say who it is, who did tell us that common good land has no future in Scotland. All the others absolutely agree that it has. And I think the empowerment, community empowerment, we didn't deal that way about the common good land, and it would be great that you could find either a stage two or by another means to try to identify something about how we could use that common good land to be something part of Scottish land reform. Why it would be good? Because let's not forget, we are trying to identify in the next 10 years all the land which has not been identified. We don't know which owners are. And I think all this identified, unidentified land should go automatically into the common land, common good land. It should be automatically going to it, and then thereafter the communities can decide what they want to do with it. So I repeat, it's not only about disposing but acquiring more. Peter Peacock called for a modernization of the TERN, and he said that we can get more of it but not less of common good land, and I do agree with him. Another witness said that local authorities are mislanding and using common good land in our own community. So we need to pay attention to this. So I think, Presiding Officer, I would like to say that we are on a journey, and this land reform bill and this stage one, it's very important. It's a step forward, and I look forward to the government response and to know how we can do it as stage two, and I would love to be able to participate in it as a substitute, as a committee. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Many thanks. And we now turn to the closing speeches. And I call on Murdo Fraser. 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. This is a very serious and important bill. The debate has lacked perhaps a little colour. I think wistfully back to the comments of my late colleague, former colleague Bill Aitken, who used to liven up these debates with rather colourful language. But I'll avoid going down that particular route this afternoon. I just want to maybe just start just by reiterating the point I made in an intervention earlier to the Minister. I do think it is a regret, and this has been echoed by a number of members around the Chamber. We didn't get the Scottish Government's response to the committee report, because we are being asked in a short time to vote on the general principles of the bill. I think it would have been very helpful to get a steer from the Scottish Government, more than we've heard from the Minister so far, as to how they will address some of the concerns and points raised in the committee report. And I think it's unfortunate that's not happening. Now, the Scottish Government like to present their land reform bill as a radical pact programme, but I think it's more realistic to see it as something of a hodgepodge of unconnected provisions of various degrees of seriousness and complexity. Some of these are welcome. Some of these we would take the view are undoubtedly damaging to the economy of rural Scotland. My colleague Alex Ferguson set out his concerns in relation to the agricultural holdings part of the bill. And I'm not going to go over the detail of that, but I think one thing is abundantly clear, both from his contributions from others that we've heard. There is no consensus, either here in the Chamber, nor was there in the committee, nor is there, even more importantly, amongst external stakeholders as to the way forward in terms of what is a very complex area of law. And against this backdrop, the Scottish Government now has to come up with a final set of proposals in the new year. And before this bill completes its parliamentary process, there will be less than 12 weeks of parliamentary time available. And it seems to me that is in no way sufficient to allow proper consideration and proper consultation in what is a very complex area. In the committee's report, page 91, there's reference to the need for significant amendment to what is currently being proposed. If that's the case, I would question whether the time is available. So I think if the Scottish Government is indeed a listening government, as they say, what they need to do is take this whole section out of the bill and bring back separate legislation on agricultural holdings in the next parliament, if they are in a position to do that. And I don't think it's good enough to leave so much to secondary legislation, given the importance of these issues. And in that respect, I would echo many of the concerns raised by Tavish Scott. In relation to other provisions of the bill, we made it clear we are supportive of proposals to increase the transparency of land ownership. We are sceptical as to the creation of a new Scottish Land Commission. I suspect that there are not many people in rural Scotland who believe that what the rural economy needs is yet another quango interfering in their activities. We do have concerns about aspects of the extended right to buy for further sustainable development. As Alex Ferguson said, this is an area where undoubtedly there is a conflict of rights. This is identified in evidence presented to the committee. Where a landowner is utilising land in a fashion where it is well and sustainably managed, for example, for productive agriculture, the landowner could still have that land forcibly transferred to a community. And we would question whether that gets the balance right. But the biggest muddle in the whole bill is in relation to the proposed reintroduction of non-domestic rates for sporting rights. Now, the Scottish Conservatives have been clear, ever since this bill was proposed, that we see this as a damaging proposal, which will simply take money out of the rural economy and potentially adversely affect employment. And we were also concerned that the bureaucracy involved in levying these rates would be disproportionate to any sums actually recovered. It is gratifying to see the committee sharing some of these concerns. And in particular, a great deal of evidence was heard by the committee about the difficulty in defining shootings and deer forests and how they would be assessed for rates. When she gave evidence to the committee, the minister was far from convincing in her arguments in support of what was being proposed. A reliable figure could not even be given for the predicted revenue, with the Scottish Government simply stating the figure of £4 million could be raised, quoting that from the £2 million revenue raised 20 years ago and projecting forward with inflation. Very briefly, I will. Yes.
Christian Allard.
Yeah, I just wanted to ask the member, thank you for taking intervention, what that kind of assessment was made when the same people were suddenly not taxed anymore for the same thing?
Martin Fraser.
Yeah, I do respond to that. I mean, the government in 1994 took the decision to remove rates. First of all, because rates were not payable in England and Wales, and therefore was a distorting effect in relation to particularly estates in the south of Scotland and the Scottish borders, and secondly, the cost of collection at that stage was getting disproportionate in relation to the amount that was actually being brought in, which seems to me still a very live issue. Now, I appreciate the majority of the committee believe that the principle of non-domestic rates on large, profitable commercial shooting enterprises is justified, but it is telling that the committee unanimously believed that the case had not yet been made for what the bill proposed, and the committee were concerned about a lot of the detail. The committee's conclusion that there is, and I quote, a lack of clarity about the purpose, delivery, impacts and likely outcome of these proposals is one which we would strongly agree. Presiding officer, in conclusion, we feel that in many ways this bill is a missed opportunity. There is no overarching vision for the future of rural land in Scotland. There is too much focus on who owns the land rather than the more pertinent question of how that land is used. And the Minister, in her opening remarks, talked about landowners and those who live and work on the land as if these were two quite separate communities, when in fact in 99% of the cases they are exactly the same person. Presiding officer, at best, this bill will be a distraction from the real issues facing rural Scotland. Depopulation, lack of connectivity, poor quality jobs and the continued loss of local services. And while there are some measures in this bill we would support, overall we think it is more likely to damage than assist rural communities, and for that reason we will not be supporting the bill at stage one today.
Many thanks. I now call on Claudia Beamish. 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Over 200 written submissions came into the Rural Affairs Committee on this bill. We have traversed Scotland in the quest for a real grasp of the complex issues involved and taken evidence, importantly, away from the Parliament in Orkney, Dumfries and Skye. I want to thank the committee clerks, particularly for the organisation of the visits and also for the work of SPICE, and I know what a big task there will be for the clerks and SPICE in January and February, so I wish them a good break. Tonight, I want to speak strongly in favour of this bill and in support of the committee's Stage 1 report. I want to acknowledge the comments of our convener and our deputy convener, and in relation to land agents, in case I forget to say that, particularly the remarks of my colleague Graham Day. As others have outlined this afternoon, the bill, though, must be more clear in its detail, and there must be as much as possible on the face of the bill. Although the time is short, we will all continue to work hard to make the best possible bill. It is not acceptable to say that we can leave this or that to the new Land Commission to deal with. Also, we must ensure that the policy memorandum is crystal clear in expressing the intentions of the bill. Anything left to regulation must, in the view of Scottish Labour, be by affirmative motion, and that is to echo also the words of our colleague Nigel Don. With Andrew Studdard as a constituent, I have seen the stark realities of legal challenge and the confusion and suffering that the consequences of this can entail. Article 1, Protocol 1 of the European Convention on Human Rights states that, I quote, the right to peaceful enjoyment of possessions is its aim. As stated in our committee report, and I quote again, it is significant, however, that the rights protected by Article 1, Protocol 1, and Article 8, right to respect for privacy and family life, are not absolute rights, and it states may states may interfere with them in order to pursue public interest objectives, provided that such interferences pursue a legitimate aim in the public interest and do so in a proportionate manner. I say, let there not be a reason for the Scottish Government to have to run scared of the fairness that this bill will produce, but let us make this a clarion call to test and test and test the bill and its aims before and during the process of the bill, so that we do not have problems afterwards in this respect with ECHR. And let us not forget, as stressed by Mike Russell, Sarah Boyack and others, the other international human rights obligations examined by the committee in oral evidence. In the words of our committee report, it is vital that the committee gives due prominence to other obligations. This is in the public interest. I'm also quite clear that sustainable development must be at the heart of this bill.
The Scottish Government didn't quite get there in the view of Scottish Labour with the Community Empowerment Act, and we're pleased to see the direction in which this is going so that the fusing of economic, social and environmental imperatives are there for rural Scotland. And I want to commend Joanne on her very much looking at the principles behind the bill and stressing that this is a justice issue. And as a previous convener of the Equal Opportunities Committee, I'm also keenly aware of the equalities issues in this bill and how the legislation should be judged against the 9 protected characteristics. I ask the Government to take great care in considering our committee recommendations in this respect, and the evidence by NHS Health Scotland encapsulates the health argument succinctly, particularly in regards to Part 5, Community Right to Buy to Further Sustainable Development. The Land Rights and Responsibilities Statement will play a fundamental role in this bill in ensuring that we move forward together. One of Environment Link's recommendations is land use and land ownership are inextricably linked, and there is a real opportunity for the land use strategy to help secure meaningful land reform if the two processes are adequately coordinated. And I hope that the Scottish Government will take cognizance of this comment, which also the committee highlights. And can the Cabinet Secretary give some reassurance on these synergies in the closing remarks? Rhoda Grant has argued for righting the wrongs of the past in the Highlands. I want to be regional for a moment as well. As I've emphasised in previous debates and on committee, there has not been the support in South Scotland and other regions beyond the Highlands for capacity building and advice. And I believe that the Community Land Fund is fundamental here. Definitions of community is complex for a multitude of reasons. The jury is still out on communities of interest in relation to the bill, and I am still open-minded about the possible need for an amendment on this. The Tenant Farmers Forum compromise, turning to Part 10 of the bill, always in my view meant the lowest common denominator, which did not reflect the need to protect tenants. Confidence to let has always been a concern expressed by Scottish Land and Estates. Clarity now in this bill, on its face, must be achieved for Part 10 as a culmination of so much work within this and previous parliaments. Scottish Tenant Farmers Association rightly expects, and I quote, the establishment of a strong tenant farming commissioner equipped with sufficient powers to create and enforce statutory codes of practice. In order to ensure a vibrant tenanted sector, which is also sharply focusing on the needs of tenants' rights and responsibilities and how these fit with the concerns of landowners, we must be sure that the new forms of tenancy work for a modern Scotland. The MLDTs are a concern still, and much work needs to be done on this in the committee's view. The modern repairing leases are an interesting possibility which needs further investigation. Fundamental to a fair way forward for tenant farmers is the development of the rent review process. And the work of the modelling group is essential, and the group should be congratulated on carving out a clearer way forward. However, there are still outstanding issues which we will reflect in this committee. Productive capacity, not least. A clear process of where you go must, of course, also be on the face of the bill to prevent further complications in the future. And I welcome, in relation to assignation and succession, Section 79 suggestions from alternatives from the Scottish Government. And the flowchart, if I understand it right, seems to provide, on first analysis, a more straightforward and fair series of steps for arrangements.
You must draw to a close, please.
Thank you. There is yet to be a response from the STFA on this, but I want to identify that Scottish Labour's comments on this are that we see a way forward. And the majority of the committee supports some form also of a limited right to buy. And Dave Thompson is right that we must address this in the bill, because it is a matter which will not go away and must be resolved. So we support the passage of the bill through stage one this afternoon in the hope that this will be a resonant way forward for the whole of rural Scotland, and that we can work together to make the bill clear and effective and unchallengeable. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Now, Colin Richard Loghead, to wind up. Cabinet Secretary, you have until 6:30.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I firstly recognise there's been many powerful contributions from members that have featured in this very important debate. And I also want to add my thanks to the Rural Affairs Committee for their hard work on this bill. And Rob Gibson, in his opening remarks, of course, referred to the extensive work carried out by members. And, of course, they had essentially a tour of Scotland. They met people from all kinds of backgrounds and all kinds of settings to discuss the implications of land ownership and all the issues around that for the future of Scotland. The energy of this debate in Parliament and outside underlines the very extensive interest in land reform in this country and the ambition that people are expressing for a radical land reform bill. Everyone, I anticipate, except the Conservative Party, who clearly have said they're voting against this land reform bill, which is not a surprise, but it is something which Scotland needs badly, and the Conservatives, unfortunately, do not want to support progress. They have even suggested perhaps this bill is illegal or it's not competent, and I have to politely remind them, of course, this bill has been endorsed by the presiding officer and within the competence of the Parliament, and they should not be scaremongering on those points. I also want to make the point to Murdo Fraser and others in the Conservative benches that this is not an urban versus rural issue. This is not about damaging the rural economy. This is about supporting the rural economy. And in my experience, and I'm sure I speak for many people in this chamber, the demand for land reform is largely coming from rural Scotland. This is something people living in our rural communities want to see happen.
Abdul Fraser.
I'm grateful to the Cabinet Secretary for giving way. Can you explain how taking £4 million in rates out of rural businesses is going to help the rural economy?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, for those of you who have looked into this issue, we do not suspect the reason why the Conservative government in the mid-1990s removed the sporting rights from rates. It was because of economic hardship. It was because the Conservative Party wanted to help out their landowning colleagues, and that was the reason. There is no evidence whatsoever that the estates suffered economic hardship due to rates pre-1995. When the Conservatives made that move. But I just want to assure the Parliament that the Government is listening to the views expressed by members in this Stage 1 debate and, of course, more importantly, to the views of the Rural Affairs Committee, who have put forward the proposal that this Parliament supports this bill at Stage 1. Many members have referred to the history of land reform in Scotland. Scotland's land has formed the backdrop for our tumultuous history, most notably the Highland Clearances, but also other key moments in our nation's story, such as the Industrial Revolution and subsequent expansion of our towns and cities. And legislators have tackled land reform down the generations. But of course, we could never rely on the House of Commons or the House of Lords, an institution even Winston Churchill said was an obstacle to progress, to do enough. But the advent of the Scottish Parliament in 1999 provided the opportunity for land reform to be given the attention it does deserve. And since devolution, land reform has been the focus to achieving a number of ambitions around fairness, equality and social justice for the people of Scotland, as many people refer to. And the 2003 Act was landmark legislation, and we have been on a journey ever since then. And since 2007, this government has updated and modernised land registration, converted tenants' rights under very long leases into ownership, and through the recent Community Empowerment Act, improved community and crofting rights to buy and introduced new rights to buy abandoned and neglected land for communities. And we've also continued to support and promote community land ownership, reintroducing the Scottish Land Fund in 2012 to provide £9 million over 4 years. And of course, we set a target of 1 million acres of land in community ownership by 2020, briefly.
Sarah Boyd.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for taking an intervention? We are desperately keen to know the areas where the Scottish Government agrees with the committee so that we can form our amendments and where you are going to be doing more work. And can you tell us when you'll respond to the committee paper? Will it be one report or a series of reports?
Cabinet Secretary.
We will be responding to the committee very shortly, but of course many members have made the very valid point that this is a very complex issue and we should not rush issues. The committee's report only came out about a week and a half ago, and therefore we are taking time to take very seriously the views expressed by the committee in the report, and we will reply to them. The rest of the measures we've taken include the Independent Land Reform Review Group set up and, of course, the Agricultural Holdings Legislation Review Group as well. And it's the work and the recommendations of these groups that underpin the proposals in the bill before us today.
We know that land reform cannot obsess with tackling historical injustices. We can't rewrite history or fight the battles of the 18th or 19th century. Today, land reform is just about as much about council estates as it is country estates, and land reform is about communities that need access to land for five-a-side pitches or affordable housing, or it's about tenant farmers looking for security to invest and diversify. And the debate, yes, has to be a contemporary one as well, about how our land can help realise our nation's potential and aspirations. But we are now writing the next chapter in land reform. In establishing the Land Commission, we're ending the stop-start nature of land reform and placing land reform across urban and rural Scotland on a very permanent basis. And Aileen MacLeod articulated many of the aims of the bill in her opening remarks. But this bill is about also supporting a thriving tenanted sector in Scotland, and indeed much of the bill makes changes to agricultural holding legislation. I therefore think it's a pity the Conservatives are saying they're going to vote against the bill because of this particular part of the bill, because Michael Russell made the point, quite rightly, this is about sharing power in Scotland. And the reason why we have to have measures to create a vibrant tenancy sector at the moment is because many people believe that the power is with the landowner, and we also need to ensure we can empower tenant farmers in Scotland at the same time.
I'm grateful to the Cabinet Secretary for taking a brief intervention. He will also realise that Michael Russell shares with me the view that this bill cannot achieve the twin aims that it sets out to do. So why does he insist on persevering with it?
Cabinet Secretary.
But the reason why we're bringing forward agricultural legislation is because there's a decline in the amount of let land in Scotland. The reason we've got an amount of decline in let land in Scotland is not because we're bringing forward agricultural legislation. We need the legislation to try and halt the decline in the amount of let land in Scotland. And as we all know, there has been a massive decline. The total area of let land in Scotland, including crofts but excluding seasonal lets, fell by 44% from 1982 to 2015. That's why we do have a number of ambitious measures in this bill to help older tenants, for instance, move on and reassign their tenancies to new entrants or those that want to progress within the sector. And we do have to do a lot more to help new entrants, again, as many members referred to as well. And that includes more publicly owned land for letting to new entrants in Scotland. We're working with the Forestry Commission. We've got 9 new units that are being let to new starts, and we'll continue to take that forward. Many other members mentioned the Tenant Farming Commissioner. I think I don't have much time left, but I just want to say yes, we do have an interim Tenant Farming Commissioner who's doing a good job just now, trying to build relationships between tenants and landlords. And that's why we have a permanent Tenant Farming Commissioner being proposed by the bill.
Too much noise.
But, Presiding Officer, we are in the midst of a momentous groundswell in support for action on land reform. This is about ensuring that one of our greatest assets benefits the many, not the few. This bill is not a one-off, it's not a quick fix. It doesn't have all the answers, and none of us in this chamber have all the answers. But this bill will implement effective and radical land reform in Scotland. It will knock down some of the obstacles communities and our citizens face in fulfilling their potential and controlling more of their own destiny. Good landowners should have nothing to fear, but bad landowners, and there are bad landowners in Scotland, will know that the law has empowered communities and individuals. And, of course, we do need to know who the landowners are in the first place. We need to know who owns Scotland. And people who own land need to know that they have rights, but also responsibilities. And people in communities need to be empowered to act when those responsibilities are not being fulfilled. So this bill and the committee's report are milestones on Scotland's land reform journey, a journey that started with feudalism but will take us to fairness. And those milestones will help make Scotland a better country, and I urge Parliament to support the Land Reform Bill at stage one.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on the Land Reform Scotland Bill. A point of order, Mr MacDonald.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. In a statement this afternoon, the Deputy First Minister said, in light of the excellent progress on the Aberdeen Western Peripheral Route, I am today confirming that work will begin in 2016-17 on the improvements to the Hodigan Roundabout. That statement did appear to represent a complete change in the Government's plans, which had previously been that work on the roundabout would not begin until after work on the Aberdeen Western Peripheral Route was completed at the end of calendar year 2017. On closer examination, however, the budget document at page 127 commits only to progress design and development work on the A90 Hodigan roundabout. Design and development work which has already been underway for some time.
Order! Let's hear the member.
The infrastructure investment plan, as issued today, says explicitly at page 107, planned to begin construction following completion of the AWPR. And Transport Scotland, only a few minutes ago this afternoon, appeared to have no knowledge of any change in government plans which would lead work to begin in 2016-17 on the improvements to the Hodigan roundabout. Mr Swinney, I'm sorry he is not here to listen to this point of order, but I am sure he would not have wished to mislead Parliament by suggesting that there had been a change in government plans or timetables for this project when there had not. And, Presiding Officer, I would ask that you give the Deputy First Minister an early opportunity to clarify the meaning of his statement on this matter this afternoon.
Thank you, Mr Macdonald. As you know, and as I have said many times before, what a member or a minister says in this chamber is not a matter for me. As you rightly say, the Deputy First Minister is not here, but I am sure that he will reflect on what you have said. The next point of order from Gil Paterson.
Presiding Officer, to the people of the Hodigan roundabout, Merry Christmas.
That was not a point of order, Mr Paterson. John Mason, is this a point of order, Mr Mason?
It is the same as the previous two.
If you have a point of order, make it now, Mr Mason.
Presiding Officer, we've raised this before, that there's clearly been abuse over the last 2 days of points of order, and I would appeal to you again to consider restricting the use of points of order.
Mr Mason, as I have told you both in writing and in this chamber, matters of points of order are for me to determine, not for you. The next item of business is consideration of motion number 15109 in the name of John Swinney on the financial resolution for the Land Reform Scotland Bill. I call on Richard Lochhead to move the motion. Cabinet Secretary.
Moved.
The question on this motion will be put at decision time. The next item of business is consideration of business motion number 15189 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau setting out a business programme. Can I ask any member who wishes to speak against the motion to press the request to speak button now? And I call on Joe Fitzpatrick to move motion number 15189.
Moved.
No members asked to speak against the motion. Therefore, I now put the question to the chamber. The question is that motion number 15189 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Yes. The motion is therefore agreed to. The next item of business is consideration of three Parliamentary Bureau motions. I would ask Joe Fitzpatrick to move motions number 15190 to 15192 on approvals of the SSIs en bloc.
Moved en bloc.
The questions on these motions will be put at decision time, to which we now come. There are three questions to be put as a result of today's business. The first question is that motion number 15181 in the name of Aileen MacLeod on the Land Reform Scotland Bill be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The Parliament's not agreed. We move to vote. Members should cast their votes now. The result of the vote on motion number 15181 in the name of Aileen MacLeod is as follows. Yes, 100. No, 15. There were no abstentions. The motion is therefore agreed to. The next question is that motion number 15109 in the name of John Swinney on the financial resolution for the Land Reform Scotland Bill be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed to. I propose to ask a single question on motions number 15190 to 15192 on approval of SSIs. If any member objects to a single question being put, please say so now. No member has objected to a single question being put. Therefore, the next question is that motions number 15190 to 15192 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on approval of SSIs be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed to. That concludes decision time. I now close this meeting.